Alpha Team report.
What's happening, Heather?
Alpha Team is responding.
Bravo?
Still nothing.
You lost both teams? Get a grip on this operation, Heather. That's Bourne. Green light, yes, sir.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time. Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth. There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is August 24th, 2016. And we're coming to you live from, well, I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific. Tonight, we started a little early at 6, but we're usually on at 7 o'clock Pacific and 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. That's a long list there. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, most importantly, self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent, by threat of force and violence. And we are happy to hear from you. You can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for all one word. And you can get all of that information at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, along with original articles, blogs, editorials, and other cool things. So definitely check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Tonight we're going to do something different, which I think many quote-unquote libertarians frown on, in that, and I don't consider myself a libertarian or define myself, period, just because all of these words have become like bastardized, and I've talked about that before. But when it comes to football, it's like, I remember talking to somebody about it. It's like they didn't want other libertarians to know. Oh, that's my alarm. They didn't want other libertarians to know that they were in a football or something. Now, if football is like your whole life and you don't give a fuck about what's going on or how your freedoms are getting taken away or anything like that, that's one thing. And I used to be really into college football even more than I am now, where I would spend all of Saturday just watching football all day. But that's, you know, one day. So I look at it as a distraction, something to get away from all of the stuff that's going on and not think about it. So for me, you know, I'm doing all this other stuff, so I don't give a fuck what other people think regarding liking college football or not. And I like college a lot more now than the NFL, because the NFL, I don't like their politics, period. Although I don't like a lot of the school's politics. Before I go any further, let me introduce our essentially guest co-host for the evening, who usually joins us for the Economy and Geo-Politics, but is also a sports fan and has agreed to do this special show with me, Ken Schortgen of The Daily Economist, who also has a new YouTube channel where you can get pretty much daily updates or close to it. The channel is just Ken Schortgen, so search for The Daily Economist or Ken Schortgen, or both probably is maybe the best way to search. And the name of the channel, Ken, is just Ken Schortgen, right?
Yep. So, and as I get more and more out there searching The Daily Economist, it'll probably come up. The only reason
it has when I search The Daily Economist, it still comes up.
The fear is that because other, if I do interviews on other places that like have been put here on YouTube, it'll show up.
Yeah, there. But yours will show up too. So put in Ken Schortgen is the easiest way to find it, and you'll find the channel and subscribe to it, and there you go.
By the way, anarchists see football as fascist because it's a game of land acquisition by force for money.
Yeah, it's a fucking game. It's, you know, it's like, I mean, I honestly, and we're not going to talk about the NFL today, really. We're going to talk, focus on college football, but the NFL has gotten into politics and it's fucked up. Even college to a point. I remember, well, it wasn't college football, it was ESPN, but I remember after the Sandy Hook shooting, right? I was watching, I'm a fan of the two teams in the state of Nevada. And one is the Nevada Wolfpack, who runs the pistol offense, is what they call it. It's because the running back is like, I don't know, I think, what, like a couple yards right behind the quarterback. And they call it the pistol offense. So they had said that weekend of the Sandy Hook shooting, I forget what day Sandy Hook happened. I'm thinking it was a Friday, so it might have been the day before, but maybe it was earlier in the week. But they said, because of what happened in Sandy Hook, we're just going to call the pistol offense the offense. I'm not kidding. That's exactly what they said because of what happened in Sandy Hook. So it's ridiculous. But the NFL has gotten into politics themselves. I mean, they promoted Obamacare and shit like that. So I don't even want to give them any of my money, at least with college. And I'm a season ticket holder at UNLV, although this year I didn't get tickets, not because I didn't want them, just because they were $600 and I didn't have the money this year. But at least, even though I disagree with a lot of things that are taught in college, at least I'm supporting, you know, colleges, as opposed to supporting the fucking NFL, which, you know, yeah, I'll watch the games. I'm still, you know, I have some football jerseys because I love football jerseys, but I usually buy them on sale. I buy the players that get traded because then they sell the shirts for like 50% off because nobody wants them because that player doesn't play for the team anymore. But college to me is so much different because you have guys that the majority of them are never going to play again. And yeah, if they're getting a scholarship, I mean, they're playing because they're getting a scholarship and getting a free education, but they're also playing for the love of the game. And a lot of them, the majority of them, are never going to play again. So, you have a certain amount, of course, that, you know, do go on to the NFL, but it's, I don't know what percentage that is, but it's a small percentage. I mean, in Division I alone, which is what we'll be talking about, the FBS is about 180. They keep moving teams up, but it's in the 180s. It might be 188 or 85 now. And that's just Division I. So imagine, you know, all the schools and all the players, and there's players in lower divisions that end up in the NFL. So, and how many players don't go on to play football? There is the CFL, Canadian Football League, and Arena Football, but, you know, that's about it. So most of the players will not be going on to play in the NFL. And even in the NFL, the average career is like 5 years. I think for a running back, it's like two. So
the average career in the NFL is 3.3 years.
Yeah, so it's even if you make it to the NFL, it doesn't even mean that you're going to stay there. So, you know, it ends up being sad for some of these guys because they think they're going to make it to the NFL and they don't, or something happens, you know, career-ending injury. And if they don't actually get their degree or, you know, learn something as opposed to having other people take their tests or, you know, breezing through because they're an athlete. And we can talk about that as well. You know, a lot of these guys end up broke. Even the ones that make a lot of money end up broke. Fuck. So, yeah, it's different than any other sport, and it's definitely the most dangerous, I would say, although boxing is pretty dangerous as well, but it's a lot more controlled in that, you know, they're throwing punches and the rounds are timed and whatever. I mean, you have all these kinds of hits in football, and I know they're trying to make it safer and they keep implementing more and more rules, which in some ways it's going too far, but I mean, player safety is a major thing. And that, I don't know if you've seen the movie Concussion with Will Smith, where the NFL was trying to basically hide the effects of concussions on players. And they didn't, because they didn't want to pay them. They have these guys, you know, 45 years old that are going nuts because of all the concussions that they had suffered. So anyway, tonight we're going to talk all about college football. We're going to talk about some of the issues that kind of relate to, you know, promoting the ideas of freedom and liberty. And then we're actually going to do something that I've probably never really done before on the show, is something that has nothing to do with freedom or liberty or any of that stuff. We're going to talk about the various conferences and the teams and who we think is going to be good this year and who is not. And I think it will be a fun show. So definitely a much more positive show than usual. Ken's not going to talk about how the whole economy is going to fall apart pretty soon and we're all fucked. So it will be a much more positive show than usual. Although one thing that you had brought up, or actually a couple things that kind of relate to that, is one of the schools in the SEC, which is the Southeastern Conference, the best conference, I think, for years now. I mean, probably about 10 years. I mean, they're always winning, you know, with the exception of, I know Ohio State won a couple years, the national championship, but it's been mostly the SEC dominating college football. And one of the schools in the SEC, which sounds insane because they make so much money from their football team, is having a budget shortfall, I guess, at LSU, Louisiana State University.
Yeah, more than the university, it's the state of Louisiana has a $1 billion budget shortfall, and they provide a ton of money to each of the universities in its state charter.
Right, because it's a state university.
Right. And going back to March of this year, in the preseason, the LSU president said the budget crisis for the state could result in half our football team being ineligible.
What is that? Why would half the football team be ineligible because of that?
If LSU is forced to close because the potential of funding.
Or are they saying
the funding, they were going to close the school.
Oh, okay.
And there's a potential problem for football players and every other athlete facing the same. If LSU is forced to close prior to the completion of the spring semester, all students would receive an incomplete grade. By NCAA rules, student athletes receiving an incomplete grade are not eligible to participate in the fall. So they were afraid that they were going to have to cut and even close the school. And here's the thing. Louisiana is going through a massive flood.
Yeah, I was just going to bring that up.
How much more money is the state going to have to do? Because Obama hasn't opened up the coffers from FEMA yet.
Isn't that in Baton Rouge as well?
It's around the Baton Rouge area.
Because that's where LSU is.
There you go.
So, I mean, that's even worse. But it's hard to believe, like, where, you know, all the money they make, and LSU is always a top 10 team. So I don't know how much money they make, but I mean, they make millions and millions of dollars off of these TV contracts, among other things, because they're such a, and the bowl games, I mean, they've been in the major bowl games where they get, you know, I think the major bowl games are in the millions just for one game.
LSU is the fifth most profitable college football program.
So there you go. And where the fuck is all the money going?
They make $33 million from ticket sales, $15 million from NCAA and conference distributions, $21 million from alumni contributions, donations, sales, and that. They made a total of $74 million. Last year, and their total cost.
And of course, they get, you know, that's not their only source of revenue at a college, but.
No, but that's just the football program.
Right. Imagine everything else.
For scholarships, head coach salary, severance payments, recruiting, team travel, game expenses, things like that, was only $25.8 million. So they made a profit of approximately $49 million.
And then you have, of course, tuition and all the other revenue streams into the school. You have government funding.
A lot of it's government. So, a lot of it is the upkeep. There's certain criteria that the state has to pay. The state has to pay teacher and professor and all the benefits that come with that, et cetera, et cetera. The tuition in the long run, depending on state schools, doesn't necessarily cover everything that's necessary. You know, this is something I've always been upset with players getting, you know, being greedy beyond belief. Because take the NBA, for example. The NBA, the latest NBA contract, the players demanded and got 55% of all the revenues. Okay.
Are you talking in the negotiation with the players' union and whatever?
Right, and the NBA.
Right, right.
Okay, so everybody talks about the greedy owners and all that. Well, the owners are responsible for the upkeep of the facility. Right. All the marketing, all the programming directors, all, you know, the whole nine yards. What about in baseball? Not only do you have to keep track of, or keep up all the minor league system, and, you know, sending out to go the scouts that have to travel all across the country. You know, there's so much overhead. Right.
You got three, not to interrupt, but the minor league system, I mean, you got three different levels, too.
Some have more.
But you have a minimum of three, right, at least. So, I mean, that alone, along with, you know, everything else that they have to pay for. I mean, to me, it depends on, you know, definitely a lot of players are overpaid. It all depends on how much money, you know, you value the player based on, like, somebody like Michael Jordan, I think, was worth the money he was paid. Because he brought so much money in merchandising and people. I mean, not even just for the Bulls, but when he would play someplace else, people would go to that game just because they were playing the Bulls and they wanted to see Jordan play. So somebody like that, that generates that much money, it doesn't mean that they deserve all the money they generate, because, you know, they're, like you said, I mean, there's all these expenses and other things. But I think he definitely deserved the money that he got, if not more. But you have a system now, and it's not just in you're mentioning baseball, where you have so many players that they're not worth what they're getting paid. I mean, they're definitely overpaid.
You know, there's an interesting, you know, I know we're diverting a little bit, but since we're talking about the money of sports in this, at least in this segment, you know, Philadelphia 76ers over the past 4 years have cut their team to the bone. They haven't gotten any high price free agents. They've traded a lot of their top picks to try to get draft picks and try to build up and wait for that one draft where they can get, you know, the mega superstar, the LeBron James of the draft.
They want another Allen Iverson.
The Phoenix Suns are doing the same thing. They've cut all their big high-priced players. They actually are below the salary cap. Now, here's an interesting thing about the NBA's salary cap rules is not only their maximum to the cap.
They have minimums.
They have minimum. And if you are below the minimum at the end of the season, you have to take the difference between the minimum level and where you're at. You take that money and you divide it equally amongst the players.
That's kind of crazy.
Well, it's good, because what you're doing is, instead of giving all the money to one schlep, like, say, Tyson Chandler, who's an old man who can barely get 7 points and 7 rebounds, and yet you're paying him $13 million a year, you get rid of him. And for the guys who actually play 30 minutes a game, even if they're not superstars, you're actually paying somebody who's playing and contributing.
Well, I mean, the fact that you have to pay that money out, I'm saying.
But,
is kind
of
crazy.
The other side of the coin is you don't have to create contracts that are onerous to you, okay? And at the end of the year, you can distribute the money and you're not on the hook for a high price contract. That's the benefit about it.
Well, the other thing is football, unlike other sports, they do sign contracts where some of the money is guaranteed, but most in general in football, they can just cut you and your contract's done.
Right.
It's not like basketball. They have to pay it out. Same with baseball.
Yep.
And baseball doesn't even have a salary cap. That's why teams like the Yankees will just fucking,
the Dodgers.
Go
the Dodgers
out
have
and
become the new Yankees.
Buy their, yeah. So,
yeah. Here's the thing. The reason that college athletics as a whole is because of the NCAA. You know, you think here's LSU making $74 million a year. You know how much the NCAA headquarters made last year?
I'm sure a lot more than that.
Because they get a cut from all the conferences. They get a big portion of cut from the television thing. Here's this organization that started out in, I think, 1934 in Los Angeles, just to sort of set the parameters for amateur athletics in college. It has become such a behemoth corporation of bureaucracy that they make $1.2 billion a year.
Yeah, that's nuts.
As an overseer, doing nothing, accomplishing nothing. They can't even correctly investigate these colleges that are cheating.
Yeah, I was going to say they're supposedly doing investigations, and that's about it. But it's based off of their rules. How are the schools? Do you know? Do the schools have any voting power? And not like it would even matter, because there's so many fucking schools.
The schools get voting power because conference wise. You know, the NCAA is the overseer, but the conferences really control the teams. There's even a conference, president. Think about that.
Right. Yeah, I know there's presidents of conferences, and they probably make a lot of money as well. And I know the conferences are supposed to, you know, they share the money between the teams. And that's a benefit of supposedly, you know, being part of a conference. If you're a team that depending where you're at. So Notre Dame is big enough. I don't know that they still are, and maybe they should join a conference, but they're an independent.
No, Notre Dame is an arrogant SOB of a school that here's what they do. Okay. They realize that as one of only three independents left in the world, in the college world, that if they didn't affiliate themselves with a conference, that they were going to get the shaft when it came to the top four teams for the playoff system.
Well, they used to be a lot better before, you know, they've been independent for a while, and they used to be a lot. Notre Dame used to be like, you know, I don't know, but they used to be a lot more popular and a lot better than they have been in the past, like 10 years.
If you think about it, you've got all of Catholicism in your back pocket. Okay.
Notre Dame is the Irish Catholics
of the Vatican.
Right.
So every Catholic in the world is supposed to be a Notre Dame.
Well, it's like why BYU went independent too. And we'll talk about this later about the issues with joining the Big 12 because they have a following. I mean, there's even a BYU channel on cable.
Well, sure. And hang on. Let me finish what I was saying.
Go ahead.
Notre Dame to not get the short shaft when it came to the college football, you know, playoff system. They joined up with the ACC.
ACC, yeah.
To do like four games.
Yep. They so just they did this recently.
They try to be in the conference championship of the ACC, but the other eight or nine games that they play are their own. They can do who they want.
Yeah, fucked up how they.
I'll give Notre Dame this.
Kind of
Notre Dame plays real teams.
No, they do.
Michigan State, Stanford.
No doubt
USC,
that they
play the teams.
They do not play any FCS teams, and we'll talk about that later. Yeah, they play tough. I mean, they always have a tough schedule.
Right.
Always.
But they had the chance a decade ago when the Big Ten was starting to, you know, move up and have the choice. Notre Dame is natural. They're in the Midwest. They play Michigan, Ohio State, Michigan State. All the time, you know, they're on the schedule, you know, 7, 8 out of 10 years. But here's the problem. NBC, like I said, because they have a contract, wanted all the money for themselves. They didn't want to split the money in the conference. Well, NBC is getting to the point that they're not going to renew the contract.
Yeah, I have heard that as well.
And so that's why Notre Dame has sort of had to jump. And they got
in the ACC. Well, they're in the ACC in all other sports.
Yeah, but it's not their regional thing. They should have bowed down long ago and joined the Big Ten, where that's where their natural region is.
Well, now they're getting it's. There's teams that are, you know, it used to be all regional, but now it's getting. You've got teams that are kind of jumping regions, and we can talk about that when we talk about the Big 12 because they're looking at teams that. You know, like West Virginia is in the Big 12. It doesn't really belong there. So even if Notre Dame, you know, joined the ACC, which yeah, it's kind of far, but not that far, being in Indiana, I mean, as long as they join a conference. But what they did was, I believe they're in the ACC for all other sports, just not football.
No, like, Notre Dame's in the Big East. Notre Dame's in the Big East for basketball.
Are you sure about that?
They up until recently, yeah.
Because I think
they're in the same division as
I'm pretty sure they're in. Yeah, that's the ACC. Miami's in the ACC. That's what I mean. This might have changed. They might have been in the Big East earlier.
You're right.
But since they made the deal.
Because they played North Carolina right. in the conference championship.
Since they made the deal with the ACC, I don't know if they were before that, but I know since they made that deal, at least, they're in the ACC for all other sports. Like BYU, I think, is in the Big West or something for other sports.
Right.
And then just for football, they're independent. So
that was kind of whacked out why BYU went, you know, ditched the
Mountain West.
But the Mountain West used to be the WAC, and they sort of they gained a few teams like Boise State and a few others. I'll tell you what, I think, you know, look, we can go ahead and transition into the Big 12 question. I personally think that the Pac-12 made a huge mistake.
So let me just
by not picking up Boise State.
But before you go on, I don't know why they didn't do that. Before you go on, just for people that don't know and aren't familiar with college football, just so we can give them a little overview, so they can kind of follow what we're talking about, is that so in college football, and we won't get into any other divisions except for the fact that sometimes they play teams in other divisions, and that's a whole nother issue, and we'll get into that. But in Division One, and it's also called the FBS, which is what and it shouldn't be anymore, though, but it's like football
bowl
subdivision or something.
Yeah.
But that now it's not, because it kind of has playoffs, but it only has a 4-team playoff, so whatever. So it's also referred to as the FBS still, I believe. But it's Division One or Division 1A or something. But it's split into conferences. So there are, nine conferences. And then you have the big five conferences now. It used to be six. And those are like the best conferences out there. So all these teams are part of a conference except for three teams now that are independents. And almost every conference is split into two divisions. So they can have a division conference championship at the end of the year. The only one that's not is the Big 12 and I believe the Sun Belt. I think every other one is split and they have a conference championship. So just to understand kind of the layout, it's pretty much but regional, but it's starting to become a little undone with regions. You have some teams that have joined conferences where they really don't fit. And it might not matter as much in football, but you got to remember that if they join that conference for all sports, that there's travel, there's, you know, the travel time, people are still going to school. So it matters being close to the teams you're playing. You know, in football, they only play 12 games. So, well, 12 regular season games. But in other sports, you know, basketball, they play a lot more. And then, you know, think of all the sports that they have at colleges where they got to go to the other school. And I don't
But taking a flight with only 13 people with limited equipment, you know, with you could take your equipment and put it in a gym bag if you're a basketball team.
Right. But what
football,
I'm saying is
you got to take, you know,
yeah, you got
90 people.
True. But what I'm saying is, but it's only like, six, you know, some teams only have four away games.
Yeah, exactly.
But when you're doing it a lot more and you're missing more class because you're or being tired because you're traveling across the country, you know, it does make a difference. And so I'm just
see that brings
so
up,
people
that brings
realize
up another,
that
another point. Okay, in the NCAA football, the except for your conference schedule. The teams are allowed to schedule their own non-conference games.
Yeah, and just before you get into that, just so another point so everybody understands that you they're not allowed to schedule their conference games, and they play everybody in their – the way it's set up is they play everybody in their division and usually three in the other division, and that's how it's set up. And then – you know, the two division winners play for the conference championship. But, sorry, as you were saying, that the other three or four games, it depends. The Big 12, it's three because they play they don't have two divisions. But they get to schedule them, as you were saying.
Yeah.
Which is kind of fucked up.
To me, the NCAA, that's where they should step in and say, you know what, Alabama – you're going to play two, you know, especially now that they have the big six conferences.
Five, say, really. Because you know, they threw out the, you know, what used to be the Big
East.
Yeah,
the Big East, right. Five super conferences. They're going to say, you know what, you're going to play of your three non-conference games. Say
or
you have
four.
12. Okay, either way, depending on how many people are in your division, because the SEC has I think 14 or 16 teams.
Yeah, it depends. Some of them do three, some of them do four.
Right. So
Most of them do four, to be honest, but that's fine either way.
Yeah, okay, we'll take four. Two of them have to be against two Super 5 conference teams. The other has to be a mid-major team, and then your fourth game can be somebody else in the FBS division.
But they have
no
to be
more FCS games.
Yeah, and that's what we were saying. The FCS is the division below the FBS. So it doesn't necessarily even mean they're not as good, because you have teams going up to Division I that really shouldn't be there, but that's a whole nother issue. But, yeah, you have teams that are like Alabama has been one of the best teams in college football for maybe the past 10 years now, for a while.
In this era.
Yeah.
You know, if you go back to the 60s and
70s. Yeah, yeah, no, that's why I'm saying like the past 10 years maybe, or 8 years or something like that. And they're playing this year some shitty fucking FCS team. And we had talked about the reason why. The FCS school gets a lot of money from it. But it's like it's an automatic win. I mean, there have been teams that have lost.
Appalachian State.
Appalachian State was the champion, I think, 1 year, or they were ranked number one. But still, you shouldn't be losing to those teams. But and then Virginia Tech a couple years ago lost to William and Mary in like their first game. So it does happen, but they shouldn't get credit for it. If you want to go, it's like an exhibition game. So as fans, you know, they're getting a win and it's counting as a win. A win is a win on their record. So not only do they have that part of it, they also have the part of it as a fan. Like, what the fuck you want to see Alabama play, you know, a team that you know they're going to blow out? I mean, I even mentioned that last year UNLV, who is not a good – is a Division I team but is not good. I think they're improving. They played Idaho State, which is an FCS team, and they beat them 80-8. And this is UNLV, who's not really that good. So I didn't really mind UNLV playing because they're not one of the greatest teams. But, I mean, even they fucking destroyed them. So if you have UNLV destroying these teams, I mean, imagine the better teams. The chances of
UNLV, I mean, there is a extremely slight chance, if they run the table, of getting into the top four.
Oh, no, I mean, that's not going to happen.
Okay,
but,
yeah. But no, you have to run the table, and you might not even get the top four.
No, if they ran the table, they still would not get in the top four.
But to get a promise to get into the eight slots for the January 1st bowl games.
So let's explain that real quick, too. So they didn't used to have playoffs. They would just have bowls. Now, the FCS, which is a division below, has a whole playoff system. And they were resistant because, as we talked about offline, the corporations that sponsor these bowls and all the money they make out of all these fucking bowls. Now, they finally, it wasn't last year, it was the year before, they agreed to, so there's been 2 years of a four-team playoff. I think there should be 16 teams. I think you said you think there should be like eight, right?
I think they should try eight to see what it's going to do, because
I think four is way too little, though.
Yeah, four is beyond way too little, because there's just too, you know, if you think about it, the rankings, because of the fact they do preseason rankings, a team that may be able enough to make it to the playoff system, many times they're not even ranked, and they got to come out of the top 25, and they got to wait till their teams, lose, and then they move their way up. And if they fortunately get into the top eight, then they might have a chance, you know. But the fact of the matter is that there is a Big Five bias. I mean, think about this.
Well, the other thing, just real quick, that I didn't mention is, along with the playoff and before the playoff, you had, what did they call them? Those five bowl games were like the...
Four bowl games. There was Fiesta, Orange, Sugar, and Rose.
Well, there were five... Oh, right, because there's, you know,
but here's
two
the thing.
Teams that play in eight teams, the big, right.
The Big Six conferences.
But what did they call them? They called them. There was a name for them, like the something bowls, but they were the elite bowls, put it that way. And if you made it to one of those bowls, you would get paid. I mean, those were the bowls that paid a lot of money.
Yeah, so they were played. Between January, after the January 1st bowls, they got moved up and they were played between like the 2nd and the 7th. Now, here's the kicker. Okay. Here's the kicker. Automatically, of those eight major bowls, which were pretty much used to determine who was the champion, the six conference winners from the Big Six conferences, when they used to have six, they got automatic bids. Now,
right.
Urban Meyer, before he was coach of Ohio State, he was coach of Florida, but before then he was coach of Utah.
Yeah, okay. That was and before that Bowling Green, actually.
Right, and Utah got in there as a one of the two outside bids. And you know who they played? They played Pittsburgh. You know what Pittsburgh's record was as winner of the Big East?
Yeah, because you told me earlier today, 7-4.
7-4, I don't care if you're the winner of a conference. You should not be playing in the big bowls.
Well, and luckily, Utah actually in 2009 got in and beat Alabama. They actually got to play a good school later, but I'm sure this was way before that. But sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and then they had TCU. TCU, before they joined the Big 12 and then eventually moved over to the SEC, they were part of the
Southwest. They're in the Big 12 still. TCU. They were in the Mountain. They were in the WAC. Oh, then yeah, Mountain right. West. Then
they went from the Southwest Conference to the Mountain
Southwest,
West.
Southwest. Right.
To
right.
The Big 12.
Right. Right.
Which is now the Big 10. And you know, see that itself.
Well, it's called the Big 12, but it's 10 teams. Right.
Right. And you know why they didn't change it when it's Big 12? And you know what? If they go to 14 or 16 teams,
they need to change the name of the. Even the Big 10 has 14 teams now. They need to change.
You know
those
why
names.
They don't change? Because they have decades worth of corporate symbols and that are tied to the Big 12 that it would be a nightmare to have to go back and change all the corporate paperwork.
See, and that's one of the things, you know, with the bowls that you had brought up, is that one of the reasons they never went to a playoff is because of the corporations, and all the bowls have names. Like, you have the Chick-fil-A Bowl, you have the Fiesta Bowl. The Fiesta is one of the elite bowls, but they still, so now they still have a couple of those elite bowls along with the playoffs. So you can still get into an elite bowl, but I'm not sure exactly how it works now.
There's a number of things, like if you have the best ranking and your record is better than the winner of a certain Big Five conference, then you have the potential to get into the bowl.
But what I'm saying is they still have a couple of those bowls along with the playoffs. So
right.
They have like three elite bowls or something, and then they have the playoffs, where before they had four, or I thought they had five, but you could be right. It could have been four. But yeah, so now it works it different, and you brought
see,
up
this
the,
is, but see, this is why the ahead. NCAA basketball March Madness is so great, because you may be bracketed accordingly, you know, top number one seeds, whatever. But guess what? Everybody has a chance.
Right.
64 teams, actually 68 now, but 64 legitimate teams have a chance that if you succeed by your play on the field. The problem is with the ranking systems and all that. Many times it isn't, you know, think about this. LSU made it to the national championship, 3 years ago? They had two losses. But because they, you know, the those who ranked them kept pushing them up above other zero loss and one loss teams.
Right. Well, because the schedule, because in the difference, a huge difference between, say, the NFL and college football, besides the fact that they have so many more teams, is in the NFL, the worst team can beat the best team. In college football, it's not going to happen. You're not going to see, like, New Mexico State beat Alabama.
No, but you could have a team that Alabama should dominate beat them because of
yes.
the system. You know,
but it's not going to be, you know, if you're in, you know, out of 180 something teams, if you're in, you know, in the last bottom 30, you're not going to beat any of the teams in the top 10.
No, but this is also why teams like Navy and Air Force, who have smaller athletes because they have size requirements to get into the academies, can on occasion beat Notre Dame.
Yeah, Navy was like 10-3 last year. I mean, Navy yep. has a good, solid team. Air Force as well. Army the last 5 or 6 years has been pretty bad. But they also play that triple option, which is hard to defend.
Because they have, you know, and what they do is they take like the Denver Broncos zone blocking scheme. Because if they went head-to-head with a defensive player in front of them, they get smashed because they can't be as big. You can't go to the weight room and get up to 300 pounds if you're a pilot.
Right. You know? Well, they go as close to like chop blocking as possible. They right. do those low blocks, the legal low blocks, but, you know, as close to as low as you can get without getting a penalty. But and then they run that triple option.
What it also does is that you don't worry about the guy you're at. You head straight for a certain zone in the line, and you're hoping that you're going to be outnumbered on one side of the ball, but you're hoping that your two or three guys can crease a hole and then run from there. And it works well because most teams don't play that.
Right. They're not used to it. They're not prepared.
Because in the long run, if you get down, those type of offenses are built for ball control and long drives. They don't have, you know, they rarely have quarterbacks that if you're down by 14 with 2 minutes left can take you down the field in a short amount of time. They just can't do it. So that's the downside of that. They hope to get the lead by attrition, wear you down, and then be able to just, you know.
Yeah, they got to play a strategy, and they try to play, you know, it's like the teams that basically, like the Pittsburgh Steelers type teams of the stereotypical ones that used to run the ball and play good defense.
Right.
That aren't built to, you know, come back from big deficits. But yeah, both Air Force and Navy and Army years ago have all been top 25 teams. They can beat some of those teams because they're not at the bottom. But I'm saying the real shitty teams that are at the bottom, like some of the Sun Belt teams or in the Sun Belt as a conference, or I brought up New Mexico State because usually they get like one win and they're terrible, or Idaho, who's actually going to drop divisions, which is unheard of. They're finally going to leave the FBS and move down to the FCS, and that
or
be
some of those conferences like the West Coast Conference, you know, with Fresno State and San Diego State and a few others like that.
You mean the Mountain West?
Yeah, the Mountain West. Now I'm thinking the basketball where like
a few
of them are with Gonzaga and that. So
yeah.
They've got to play that spread offense wild thing because you know what? They can't recruit. They can't recruit 5-star, 4-star, and barely 3-star athletes to be able to compete with those.
Well, that's because, you know, like they're talking about the Raiders coming here to Las Vegas.
Exactly.
And they're talking about building a dome stadium. Now, if they can get a dome stadium in Las Vegas and the Rebels can play there, I guarantee, because there's a lot of good players coming out of Vegas. DeMarco Murray, the running back who used to play for the Cowboys that came out of Vegas. Bishop Gorman is always in the top 10. I don't know if you've heard of the school, but the school Bishop Gorman is a private school here in Las Vegas. And that's where DeMarco Murray went. And
yeah,
I
know Arizona put together sort of an all-star team to go play their school.
Yeah, so there's a lot of good players coming out of Vegas. The whole problem is they're not going to UNLV. They're not staying here. They're going to other schools. Like DeMarco Murray went to Oklahoma because he was a really good – he was a high-star recruit. But if we're able to get the facilities – if the Raiders end up coming here and they build a stadium that UNLV plays in, I guarantee you that UNLV might not only be able to recruit a lot of those players, but they may be able to go into a top five conference as well, because it's a market that people want to get into. I mean, there's over 2 million people, I think like 2.5 in the greater Las Vegas area. So, right now the Mountain West is like a it's not one of the top five. It's like right below that. But the past couple years, they had a bad year last year. They have Boise State, they have San Diego State, which are solid teams.
Yeah, but Nevada Reno actually has had...
They've had some good years, too.
Yeah, I mean, Kaepernick that year. Yeah.
They went 13-1.
They beat Boise State because Boise State's kicker couldn't make a simple chip shot.
Yeah, I watched that game. They they should have beat Hawaii. They should have went undefeated because the game they lost to Hawaii. And what happened was Kaepernick put the ball out like to the end zone, and it got knocked out of his hand. And it looked like he scored a touchdown, but they counted it as safety or something. And then they lost by a touchdown. But they've had solid seasons. Fresno State was ranked a couple years ago with Derek Carr. So they've had some good, they used to have Utah and TCU who were, went on to better conferences, because they were really good. So, UNLV, if that happens, it could become one of those, next level schools, but their coach is the former coach of Bishop Gorman. They actually hired a high school coach. I don't know how good of an idea that was, but he knows a lot of those players. So, he's obviously fighting to recruit them. But yeah, I'm sorry. Your point originally was they play a lot of the spread offense or whatever.
Yeah.
Because
and,
they're not getting
it's interesting,
the players.
You know, taking that forward to the NFL, the Chip Kelly, his spread offense was able to, dominate in the NCAA from Oregon. And he goes to the NFL. And, of course, everybody, the traditionalists, you can't bring innovation or something new to the NFL. It doesn't work. And they criticized him every single time. Well, you know what? The difference with the NCAA and the NFL is you can recruit your own players in the NCAA. You can, you have a system. You can fit the right players into it. In the NFL, if you move up as a coach, you're going to have a bunch of guys who are based on traditional, and they just can't play that system.
Well, most of the time, also, you're not the one picking the players. The general manager is.
Right.
If you're Bill Belichick, it's a little different where he's, basically doing everything. But
he's got a GM, but they are on the same page. They're exactly on the same page. You remember the start of the dynasty for the Patriots, they had Scott Pioli was the general manager.
Right.
And then Pioli, I think, went over to Kansas City.
Right. I mean, they have a general manager, but I mean, at this point, because of what he's done, he's pretty much able to.
What you're referring to is that even though there's a general manager, Belichick is in charge of player personnel, while the general manager deals with making sure that all the numbers fit.
Right, right. Yep. So where other places, The general manager brings in a lot of the players, and the coach coaches the players that he gets. You know, I'm sure they talk and whatever, but it depends on the coach. So, well, Chip Kelly, he did okay, even though he got fired, but now he got hired someplace else. So
yeah, and Chip Kelly really got screwed because, you know, he went 10-6, 10-6 2 years in a row, maybe with playoffs one of the 2 years. But, you know, he was stuck in with a bunch of what I would call divas. LeSean McCloy, Shady, was getting older, was demanding a new contract. You know, he just – and then DeSean Jackson from Berkeley, from Cal, I think. You know, he was a diva of the highest order. He wouldn't listen to coaches. He wanted to do his own thing. Jeremy Maclin was a reasonable running or a wide receiver, but he got traded. You know, and Chip Kelly was trying to clear out the house, but once he did not get Mariota in the draft, you know, the writing was on the wall because Bradford got injured last year and he was stuck with a
well. That's the guy he wanted. I don't know why, but they said that Chip Kelly wanted Bradford. I don't know why he wanted Bradford.
Well, he wanted Bradford because Bradford, you know, there was talk he wanted Kaepernick. But the price was too high. You know, what you hear in the news doesn't necessarily equate what's going on behind the scenes.
Right,
Bradford would have been the worst person for that type of spread offense because the dude has had so many ACL and MCL knee injuries. How can you – you know, be a run option if you're a quarterback. So he needed a run option quarterback that could also see the field and pass. And, you know, that's the thing about Chip Kelly's offense. Chip Kelly's offense is that we have the play is set and it's to one receiver only. And if he's not open, then you got the run option. But it's not like a normal standard quarterback set where you have three receivers and you've got options 1, 2, and 3. And then once it breaks down, you know, it breaks down. With Chip Kelly, you have one option. And if that option breaks down, then you're running.
Well, that's why I think he'd want, like, he didn't try to get, you know, RG3 or whatever, even though he...
But RG3 was also injury prone.
Yeah. But, I mean, not to be the number one guy, but to compete, you know, to bring him in. Because right now, you don't have to pay him... You know what he
true, but look what he's got. He's got Kaepernick, paid. But he's got the worst offensive line in the NFL, and in a lot of the guys in the defensive line either retired early or they got busted and they're out. You know, see, it's in the same boat. If Chip Kelly could have a 5-year contract where they let him go carte blanche and do what he would, you know, the record be damned, and pick his team in that, I think he'd have the opportunity to really make some, you know, bold moves to be different than what everybody else is.
Well, they want you to win right away because some coaches have gotten lucky and come in and like Harbaugh, who's now back with in college with Michigan, came in and, you know, had an effect right away or,
true,
you know, but they get lucky. They already have a team reason, built up or.
Right. There is a reason why in the NFL there's so many teams that are perennial losers all the time. And it's not because they don't, you know,
like the
they
Cleveland
don't get all
Browns.
The drafts. Cleveland Browns. It's organization. You know, you can keep a coach for 1 or 2 years if he doesn't give you a winning record and fire him and fire the GM and hire more. You could have the best coach at a place like Cleveland, and you'd still lose. It's because the ownership and the thing. And I find this too.
Redskins are a losing organization as well.
College does the same thing. Only, yeah. You know, the problem with college is that there is no loyalty. If you have a superior coach. Okay, he is on the path towards getting.
He's leaving for a better school.
Ultimate job, right?
Yeah, because you actually have that with you had the coach of Houston when they had Case Keenum. Was that Charlie Strong?
No, Charlie Strong was Texas.
No, he
A&M.
Was right.
He went to Texas.
But was that the didn't?
No,
didn't
wait.
He
Charlie
used
Strong
to be the
was with
Houston.
Louisville,
right.
And then he went to the thing. And you know what? He sucked at Texas.
But
you have the biggest
Yeah.
Recruiting ground in history and the tradition, and you still suck.
Yeah, Texas has been bad now for 4 years. And you have teams, that, and like you were saying, like in college football, you know, every 4 years minimum, I mean, some players leave in three, you're getting new players. So it is all about the organization and the ability to get these guys to come to your school and recruit them. And, you know, like you said as well, you look for guys that fit into your system and stuff like that. But at the same time, you have dynasties or you have schools that are consistently good over a long period of time. Like you have Alabama has been good now for, you know, almost a decade.
Right. But there's a huge dichotomy when it comes to the SEC conference and say, you know, the Pac-12. Okay. Who's a perennial great team, usually top 10 for the past decade as well? Stanford. And Stanford has
I wouldn't say decade. They maybe past 5 years, because before Andrew Luck, they really weren't. They weren't really up there. But Andrew Luck actually, he's been in the NFL 4 years now. So yeah. So maybe five. Yeah, something like that. Okay. Stanford. Same with Oregon is pretty recent. You know, about the same time as well. Maybe 6-7 years. Oregon's been a solid team, although they're on the downslide right now, and we'll talk about that later.
Chip Kelly left. They started going downhill when Chip Kelly left. But here's the thing. In college, you don't need the organization. You just need a coach, and you need a coach who knows how to recruit. Okay. The difference, say, between Stanford and Alabama is Alabama's and LSU and Clemson, their requirements to get into the college.
Well, I was just going to say that they're harder.
Bottom feeder, you know.
Stanford has it's like a really good school.
To be an athlete there, you have to pass the same curriculum requirements as a normal student. Okay, so you can get athletes who don't really, you know, who can barely speak English, fifth grade literacy,
into Alabama,
and so they're going to get the vast majority of athletes from, you know, who wouldn't make it into academics of regular school. This is a lot of the reasons why SEC gets some of the best athletes, because if you look at their average graduation rates, their average GPAs, their average test scoring, they're usually the bottom of the barrel. But
Why, like, Vanderbilt is always at the bottom.
Pretty much, yeah.
Because they're a good school. They're hard to get into.
That requires high, you know. But, you know, depending upon the coach, you know, take a look at Duke. Duke is a private school. It's got high requirements to get in there.
Yeah,
but
they do.
They
as
always
well.
Have great basketball programs.
Basketball, yes, but football, they haven't until the past few years. They've had a couple good seasons, but in general, their football program hasn't been too good.
Yeah, you know, you'll take a look at, you know, it's also, you know, the requirements to get in Ohio State are much less than to get in Michigan.
I did not know that. I know my ex-girlfriend actually went to Ohio State. I always thought Ohio State was a good school.
It's better than all those in the SEC, except for Vanderbilt. But it's not as, you know, the rigor, the requirements to get in Michigan are much, much higher. Michigan is known far more for its academics than it is for football, even though it's big on football.
So that, I mean, that's a good point that you brought up, too, because what that does is obviously it gives schools an advantage. If you're, you know, your school, your minimum requirements to get in aren't that high, you know, you're a bottom school. I mean, to get into college, you still got to meet minimum requirements. But if your requirements are a lot lower compared to a lot of other schools, that gives you an advantage right there. So that's a good point where for a team like Stanford to do as well as they've been doing the past, you know, 5-6 years is means a lot more than a team like Alabama. Although, you know, Alabama is more recent, you know, when Nick Saban came in and whatnot. So it's not just the fact that, yes, they can, you know.
But it
definitely factors in.
Right, and it tells you that in college, you don't need necessarily the organization. A great coach can take a team from, you know, absolute obscurity and take them to, you know, near the pinnacle, if not to the top.
If he's a good recruiter along with being a good football coach. I mean, I think that's something that is a huge part, obviously, of college football is recruiting and going out and to convince players to come to your school.
See, there's two great examples over the past 20 years of schools that for, you know, 40, 50, 60 years have been bottom feeders and that, and a single individual comes in and changes the entire scope, changes everything. The first one is Bill Snyder at Kansas State. You know, when Snyder was hired at Kansas State back in 1988, he hired a team that had a cumulative record of 299 and 510, a 370 winning percentage in 93 years of play. And the that coach took Kansas State to three straight division titles over the Nebraskas, the Oklahomas, whatever. And then when Kansas State, when he left and sort of retired, moved into the AD position.
And he came back.
And he came back, and Kansas State has been looking good for the last three.
Yeah. So and
a single individual can do this. The other was, I can't remember the coach's name. I think it's Fitzpatrick. But up in Northwestern. Northwestern was always absolute bottom feeder for decades.
Well, they're and a good, Northwestern's a good school academically, right?
Right. But they've gone to three Rose Bowls in the last 10 years.
Yeah, they've been playing they've had some seasons where they had a good first half and then a bottom – the second half was pretty bad. But last year they had a very, very good season, actually, Northwestern. They did have a favorable schedule, but still, I think they went 10-3, and they had a really good season.
You know, and another thing, too, when you look at college is you look at the coaching tree, you know. Like I said, Bill Snyder's one of those obscure names. He's not Saban. He's not in the public. He's not, you know, the god of Kansas State, of the state of Kansas, like Nick Saban is the god of Alabama.
Well, they did name, I think, the stadium after him.
Right. But here's the dichotomy. Using the same criteria, Kansas University has barely won any games.
Yeah, I was going to say that. So
the same amount of time.
You look at Kansas, and they've brought in all of these coaches. At one point, they had Charlie Weiss and all these other coaches. So, what is the? Have they just not found the right coach yet? Because they haven't had. At least as long as I've been following college football, and it hasn't been that long, maybe 10 years, I've been really into it. I got into college football more recently than I used to just be into pro football, and I'd follow college a little. But I've been following it really closely for a little less than 10 years now. But they've been terrible. They've never had they win one or two games every year. And you know, they should be able to, they're in a good conference. They should be able to recruit if they find the right person to recruit. So is that, what is the issue in a school like Kansas that's just sucked for, you know, a decade almost.
Yeah, well, at least I think that you know, part of its location, but you know, you're still in the Big 12.
Well, that's what I was saying. You're in a good conference.
Yeah,
the Big 12
for a long time was really down to three teams. You know, until the late 80s, 90s, you know, it was either Texas, Oklahoma, and Texas A&M. That was it. You know, the Kansas States, the Missouris, you know, they were all bottom feeders. They were never, you know, even Oklahoma State was really never up there. So, you know, you're seeing the sea change, and it's ironic that Missouri and Texas A&M moved to the SEC, which led to the fact now that the Big Ten last year only had 10, or Big 12 only had 10 teams, and now they're looking to finally recruit. There's a big question. Are they only going to take two teams?
Or four, yeah.
Or four, or maybe even six. Because I think the goal of the super conferences, the five super conferences, is eventually have them all get to 16 teams. So they can have two divisions of eight. If you have 14 teams, you've got two divisions of seven. It can be odd years and things like that.
Well, I think they need standards on, if you're in Division One, you can't just, you know, just come in Division One. I mean, you have the Sun Belt and the MAC and what's the other Conference USA just inviting teams that are, you know, coming up from lower divisions, and there's no, as far as I know, there's really no standards to say that, okay, you're good enough where you can come up into Division One.
Well, true, but the fact of the matter is that the whole thing is about money. It's about television. It's about creating this dynasty. And you know,
but that doesn't help bringing up shitty teams.
Well, you're not going to bring up. You're really okay. Look, there's two criteria for an FCS team to move up to FBS. You know what those are?
I think you just have to be invited by a conference.
No. You have to have a stadium, and you have to have a certain attendance level.
Oh, well.
Secondly, you have to have a certain attendance level in your university. It's a combination of both.
Yeah, but that's not really, because I think the, it's got to
like
be
University of Montana.
It's got to be low, the amount of the stadium amount.
Look, the University of Montana, okay, the University of Montana is every year in the top five in the FCS.
Yeah, I think a Bobby Houck, who coached UNLV before that, coached Montana.
Exactly, took him and played Georgia State, Southern, and Appalachia State, right, and all those. Okay, how many seats Dahlberg or Grizzly Stadium has up in Missoula, Montana?
No idea.
12,000.
Yeah, that's Max obviously 12, way too small. But yeah. I think it's got to be, you know, it can't be more than like 35, because UNLV, I mean, they can get it up to 45, but Sam Boyd Stadium, the capacity is 35,000 normally.
But it's tempered with that, and it's also tempered with your population in your college.
Yeah, the school's huge. I mean, UNLV is a big school.
Missoula, Montana has only 95,000 people in the city and the surrounding area. Okay.
Yeah, so the school is obviously pretty small.
Since it's the only game in town, yeah, you can usually fill 12,000 into a stadium, but you're not going to really get a whole lot more. So Montana will never get it, you know, get into that point.
But that
Boise State, on the other hand, Boise is the capital. It had a big school, and it's got a huge stadium that they built, and it's got a
right,
reputation
with the nice blue turf there, the Smurf turf.
Exactly.
But the none of that, right, is going to has anything to do with if your team is good or not.
It doesn't matter.
You
good.
Know what I mean?
In the end, it doesn't matter good. Okay, it matters of can you fill the seats and fill this, because there's a, you know, if you want to think about it, it's sort of a a pecking order now in the super big conferences. You know, and something you got to take in consideration too, a lot of these conferences have been raping teams from the Conference USAs, from the, you know, And then those have to recruit from what we would consider
the dregs. Exactly what happened, because what happened was Conference USA got raided by what is now the American Athletic Conference, which used to be the Big East. Basically, half of the teams that were in Conference USA went there. Then the WAC, which originally had all the Mountain West teams anyway, the Mountain West broke off from the WAC. They lost a few teams, and then they kind of raided the WAC, and then the WAC just went away totally, which is it's a fucked up name for a conference.
Well, the WAC sort of just became one side of the conference. You know, Mountain West took you know, the Colorado States of the world on one side and the BYUs on the other, and they took the WAC and then the Mountain West Conference and sort of just made it the Mountain West Conference. But the two divisions are like the Mountain West Conference on one side and the WAC on the other.
Sort of, yeah. I mean, but so the WAC totally went out of the two teams, New Mexico State ended up in like the Sun Belt because they had nowhere to go. And Idaho, we talked about them, that they're just leaving. I think they might be in Conference USA right now, but nobody wants them, so they're leaving. But that might be because they might have a small stadium and no one's coming to see the games, and I don't know. UNLV is actually playing them this year, but this is their last year in this division. But so there were a couple other things that I wanted to cover before we actually get into predictions and get into teams and stuff like that. So one of them was as we've been talking about teams or conferences rating other conferences and the setup of the conferences. In the past maybe 5-6 years, there's been huge changes in the conferences. There's been people moving and the rating going on of, you know, and then all the schools moving up. So we've mentioned the Big 12 and how you mentioned the question is whether they want to add two teams or four teams.
Right, but I think we want to go over each of the teams and determine what we might see would be the best fit for that, because I got a list of the teams here.
Well, one of the issues I wanted to bring up, though, and then we could get into the specific of the teams, is that, because this is more of a political issue, is they're telling them, so BYU, Brigham Young University, in Utah, is a Mormon school. It's run by the Mormon Church.
Right.
And when I say they, I don't know who they is, but there's reports that there are certain groups, the quote-unquote LGBT community, what that means, who knows, because I don't know how you have a community, but whatever, that they are telling the Big 12 that don't take BYU because they discriminate against gay and trans people. And BYU would actually be a pretty good fit, except that they're in Utah, although Utah's not that far. I don't think it's too far from you know, Texas and Oklahoma and Kansas.
But no, it's Colorado's in between.
Yeah, you know, it's
Kansas right there between Colorado. So Texas is Colorado's in between, and Texas at the Panhandle is just right there. So yeah, I mean, you're not that far away.
So do you think, before we can get into the list of teams, and there's actually a whole bunch. I mean, basically the whole Mountain West applied.
Right.
Even UNLV applied, actually. I don't think Nevada did. But what are your thoughts on, you know, BYU and making a, because they, I don't remember them ever making a big deal about BYU being in the Mountain West or being before that they were in the WAC.
Okay, let's take a look at some of their stats. We'll go, we'll use BYU first. Their closest Big 12 school is Texas Tech, 872 miles away. You know, what's that? Hour and a half flight, big deal. Their enrollment is 29,000, which is about half of what Arizona State is, so that's not bad. Their stadium holds 63,700 people.
Yeah, and they have a huge following, as we established. I mean, that's why they were able to go independent and still support themselves, and they even have their own fucking channel. You know, the university.
The question with BYU, though, is that BYU has their basketball teams in a different conference.
Right, but they could move. They talked. They, what I had read was they could do either one. They could move everything. And BYU has a good basketball team, usually. They could move everything into the Big 12 or just football. But well, they're open to both.
Well, here's the other thing. Like Notre Dame, BYU has their own television network.
Right, that's what I was
So are they going to be willing to share that with the conference? Just like Texas decided to get their own network too, and they got you know, bitch slapped for
that.
They
got a lot of shit for it, yeah.
Yeah. No, the
But BYU's, I don't know that they're airing the games exclusively on the network. I mean, they have like a school network or like a Mormon church kind of network. It's more about the religion than the fucking games. So I don't know what the...
Well, no. The thing about it is being independent, they have probably Fox Sports West. That's what their football is tied to. Okay. Well, the Big 12 might want to jump in with ESPN and be part of that, you know.
Right.
Sports Saturday.
Yeah, Big 12 is one of the few conferences that don't have their own network. And Mountain West doesn't anymore, neither. It's internet. But they used to.
You know, ironically, who else has a crappy television deal? The Pac-12. They have a horrific one.
Well, they have.
They don't even make like a third of the money that these new deals with the Big Ten conference has. Yeah. And the
well, SEC. They finally got their own network too, but nobody gets it.
Yeah, it's like it's special order on cable.
Yeah, it's or, not
or
on.
I think it's on DirecTV or whatever, but not on cable.
Right, but I don't get it. And I got DirecTV, and I get almost every fucking sports channel, but I don't get Pac-12. So I think you might have to pay extra for it or something.
Yeah,
and I got like a sports package where I get the Big Ten network. I used to get Mountain West when Mountain West had a network.
By the way, I think that's something. This is, you know, in the long run, The days of cable and special networks like this are going to be gone, because the ability for the internet, somebody to just hook up their TV to a live stream.
Well, you have ESPN3 right now where they air all the ESPN games are you can get on the internet.
Yeah, exactly, and I've got you know, a number of European sources. There's a website out there. I can get every single game and stream it to my laptop, to my tablet, to my phone, to my whatever. I can watch every game on whatever. Cable is going to go by the wayside. How is this going to affect, in the long run, these network contracts with these teams? That's going to be a really fascinating thing. Within the next 5 to 10 years, we're not talking, you know, decades from here. We're talking barely 5 to 10 years. The cable system as we know it is going by the wayside. Just take a look at the fact that Amazon, Netflix, Hulu, these types, HBO, they're creating their own content, and it's some of the most
HBO
popular
has been
content.
Doing that for 20 years,
right?
They've been creating their own content. But,
yeah, but usually was it sort of documentaries or boxing?
No, it was. They had shows like the show Dream On, First and
true.
10, and so they've been doing it for years. But like Netflix is a good example, or Amazon Prime
Exactly.
Amazon has their own shit as well.
How long until these entities start subsidizing and grabbing football conferences or football games? You know, the sport. There's a reason why the NFL puts a game on Thursday night, Sunday night, Monday, because football. No matter what other, you know, the finale of MASH or the finale of NCIS, if it ever come around, those wouldn't hold a candle to a simple playoff game in January for an NFL. You know, Cleveland versus Tampa Bay would get more people watching it than any other show.
Right.
So, you know, the future of that, how is it going to affect college football? So that's another thing. If these entities, so BYU's got, you know, they've got a good record over the past 5 years, 43-22. They're currently independent. They've got enough enrollment. They've got enough stadiums. They're within 1,000 miles of the closest team, so flight's not really out of the way. You know, so let's take a look at Cincinnati.
And they don't have – the other thing is they don't currently have a deal that they have to buy out of because they're independent. Because
right.
Some of these conferences, they sign contracts like when they moved conferences. Like BYU – not BYU, Boise State had to pay like $5 million to the American Athletic Conference because they were supposed to join and they changed their mind.
Now
they had to pay a bunch of money because of that.
The other benefit for BYU is BYU has a relatively decent basketball team, which would complement the Big 12, which they're more known right now for.
They're
for
getting good in basketball.
They've always Kansas,
but they're getting Kansas has always been good. But I mean, Baylor's good now. Texas, good. A lot of these teams, Oklahoma with the former UNLV coach,
Lauren Kruger, usually pretty good.
So, Missouri's now in SEC, but
yeah, that's true.
They're becoming a pretty good basketball conference. So, and BYU has always had a good to average basketball team.
So this is something they'd look into because this is going to be one of Boise State's biggest detriments. Is there a football school? But the rest of their sports really don't.
But no, their basketball has actually been pretty good over the past three, four years.
But it's really not.
They won the Mountain West last year, actually.
Yeah, but it's not a Super Five conference, you know, equivalent. Or it'd be like coming into the Big Ten and beat your Indiana State, you know.
Yeah, I think it's good, but I think it's good enough. That because of their football, that it wouldn't be, I think it'd be a non-issue. I think more of an issue would be the fact that they're in Idaho and they're even further
Boise
away.
State is the opposite of Gonzaga. Gonzaga has the great basketball program, but they don't even have enough potential for any football.
They don't even have a football team.
Exactly.
Right?
So they don't have a football team. But they're right now, over the past decade, they are considered one of the top 10 best college basketball programs. Boise State, in reality, over a decade, going back to the Fiesta Bowl win over Oklahoma, they are considered one of the top 10 football behemoths over the past.
Yeah, I mean, the past couple years, they've dropped a little, but they've been pretty consistent. And even in those years, they've still had at least nine
wins. They had
one
really bad year. And that they were still over 500, but
had to do with injuries. I think they had a bunch of injuries
last year they
were still 9-4. I mean,
they were a game away or two games away. They fell down the stretch, but they were two games away from potentially making it into the big bowls. But Cincinnati is an interesting choice.
See, Cincinnati, distance-wise, how far? I know
they're 304 miles.
They're almost in Kentucky, basically.
They're 304 miles away from West Virginia.
Yeah, they're close to West Virginia, but West Virginia is already far away from all the other. I didn't get that whole move.
But just remember,
West Virginia. They should have brought Louisville. I don't know why they brought West Virginia.
Once you go west of the or east of the Mississippi, the states aren't very big. Relatively, they're not big. I mean, Missouri and Nebraska are big. But once you get into the others, they're relatively small.
No, I know. Coming from the east.
They've got they've got 40,000 people in their stadium seating, which is a little bit low. Enrollment of 44,000, which, you know, is 1.5 times the size of BYU. They've got a large sports-based city, Cincinnati. They're already tied to the American Athletic Conference, so that's going to be a downfall. You know, are they going to be able to leave that after they just pretty much got in it?
Right. They're going to have to do a buyout. That's why I was saying, like, BYU, the positive thing was being an independent. They don't have to buy out of a conference. But Cincinnati probably has an existing contract that they're going to have to buy out of to get out of it. As will probably some of the other schools as well. But
the other side of the coin is that Cincinnati actually has a pseudo big name coach, Tommy Tuberville.
Oh, right.
You know, who was SEC for a number of years.
Yeah, yeah. No, I know the name.
The one that stands out for me has always been Colorado State.
They've had one good year in the past, I don't know how many years. They went 10-3, not last year, but the year before. Last year, they did go to a bowl game. They lost. They were to Nevada. They were 7-6. But they've had two good years. Besides that, their football team has been terrible.
Right, but what
basketball? They have a solid basketball program.
The thing is, one of their pros is that they've got a new stadium set to open in 2017.
That might help, but I mean, they're not. And I mean, I guess they're going in the right direction, but as of right now, I don't think it's enough. Where they, you know, you want to see more good seasons.
Colorado State's in the same problem as UNLV. You know, it's like forever bridesmaid, but never going to be the bride.
Right.
East Carolina is kind of interesting. The Pirates, because they have a really decent baseball program that goes to the NCAA regionals and super regionals every year.
How important is? I mean, really, no, but basketball. But
when you're a big super conference, the expectation is that you better play more than one sport. Okay. They've posted, even though the football record doesn't blow people out of the water, fans go and support this team big time. They average 44,700 fans per home game. The next in their conference only averages 29,000. Plus, they're willing, East Carolina has a tendency to be one of those teams that the Super 5 conferences play in their out-of-conference schedule. So they're not considered the FCS, you know, free boot, but they are used to playing tougher competition each year.
Yeah, but same thing. I mean, they've had a couple good years when they had I forget the quarterback's name, but they haven't football wise and basketball. I don't know that they've really done.
Well, here's the thing.
Much neither.
Is if you're a team that's on the cusp, okay, team on the cusp, by joining a Super Five conference, you've automatically created, you know, bettered yourself. Because
right,
your
it's going to up gonna your
be
recruiting, right?
Yeah,
but I don't know that they're even, you know, high
their
enough.
Their basketball
to...
team isn't really in there.
No.
But they are part of the Tobacco Road area, you know, Greenville, North Carolina. You know,
depends on markets too. Sorry to interrupt, but they, you know, expanding into new markets is something that was talked about as well. And they, like, Florida was mentioned because, you know, expanding into Florida, of course, you're limited with, you know, two teams basically, which is UCF and USF, because of course Florida State and Florida aren't going anywhere.
Well, but you know what? That's an interesting thing you say that, because ESPN has been discussing the possibility of Florida State.
Well, they did
moving in there
in 2012. I read that they actually did. apply to the Big 12 back in 2012, I believe.
Right. And I think that was also before the they got their you know, super quarterback, which, you know, he was able to dominate the ACC for a number of years. And they also got their coach. You know, he brought that in. So they've won a national championship in that time. So, you know, is it easier for them to succeed in the ACC than it would be for the Big 12? That was one of the reasons why they were considering moving to the Big 12, because they thought it would be a lot easier to win the conference.
Now it's the opposite, I think, that the ACC is not as good as the Big 12. And the
who in the Big 12 is really good? Oklahoma had a decent year last year. Oklahoma State was like,
Oklahoma, you know, I mean, they all had 10 wins. TCU had 10 wins.
Yeah, but look who they're Baylor, look at their conference, look
Oklahoma,
at their
conference thing. Oklahoma yeah, State.
Right.
Kansas State is you know.
Who is Florida State's two biggest nemesis in the ACC?
Well, you got Clemson.
There you go. Went to the national championship last year.
Yeah, but they
knocked out Florida State in the championship game.
That was 1 year, and this year they're probably going to do it too.
Do you think Florida State could whip up on Oklahoma? Oh, yeah. Or Baylor, you know.
Florida State got beat by Houston last year.
Yeah, but Houston was an anomaly last year. Houston was an anomaly. I mean, they're usually a better than average team, but they were Louisville of a few years ago when Charlie Strong took them, you know, to that bowl game.
The thing, though, with the Big 12 is that they play a totally different type of football than other conferences. They're more in general, and this is a general statement, but the majority of the teams are they put up a lot of points. They play great offense, and most of the defenses suck.
Well, here's the thing about the Big 12, what has changed. Okay, the Big 12 plays, as opposed to most of the SEC, which SEC is like the old Big 10, you know, run first, control passes, etc. But the Big 12 is a pro style offense. They throw as much as they run. Okay, look at the quarterbacks that have come out: Chase Daniels, who are a few?
But Robert Griffin.
These are guys. Yeah, Robert Griffin. But these are guys who came out for the most part.
Colt McCoy.
They
Sam
came out
Bradford.
With pro style offenses, and that's why they were high draft picks going into the thing because
well, Bradford
they were more
was
pro ready.
He was a number one draft pick.
Right.
Robert Griffin was a number two. Colt McCoy was a third round, but I think it's because he was too short.
A Kansas State quarterback got picked up. I forget his name. He didn't really do too much.
Yeah, the one that was there when they were playing pretty good a couple years ago, right?
Right.
Yeah, he did. I think
not
he was
Dockett
like the third,
or Lockett, something like that.
Third on the depth charts. Well, because he can do other things. I mean, he can run the ball. You could use him as a running back. I mean, if you wanted to. There was a lot of things that he could do. So.
The other thing is somebody added that Florida State could instantly make the Big 12 competitive with the SEC as the best football conference next to the SEC. If the Big 12 was able to pick one of the, you know, like a Clemson or because you know what? Because when you lose Texas A&M, which is one of your mainstays for your entire existence, Missouri is like middle of the road. But if you could get one of the top 10 teams of that, you would instantly put the Big 12 at or near the Big 10 in relation to the SEC.
Right.
So that would be why they might do a push for that. Now getting to Houston.
Well, yeah, if Florida State was willing to come to the Big 12, I mean, of course you'd take them.
Right,
there's no reason
not
to. It's just a matter of, well, would Florida State want to go there? And I would think not, even with Clemson. I mean, because really, it's just Clemson. I mean, you look at their division, It's Clemson and Louisville, and I think they're a better team than Louisville in general over the years, especially. I mean, Louisville had when they had what's his name, the quarterback of Minnesota now,
Bridgewater,
and yeah, I mean they had a couple good years, but that's about it. I mean,
no, Louisville's always been competitive.
They're a really good basketball team.
Yeah, and they're fun to watch. And competitive, so they get their fan support, and that's something else too. You know, a lot of these conferences will take a look when they're recruiting in, is how does the team look on television when they pan, you know, do a panorama around the stadium? Do they have a full house every time? Because if they don't, that's something that really does affect recruiting. It affects the legitimacy of the conference.
Right.
But let's talk about Houston wanting to get in.
Houston, I think it's gonna be BYU and Houston if they take two, to be honest. But that's just,
they seat 40,000 people.
Yeah, that's not good. But...
they're pros. Houston's football team is on the up and up with head coach Tom Herman at the helm. Getting into the Big 12 might be a good way for Houston to actually keep him.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that he's gonna leave. If they don't move to. To the Big 12.
Let's see. By adding Houston, you'd be giving recruits a reason to go to Houston instead of, say, Texas or Oklahoma or Baylor. And Houston is becoming one of the bigger metroplexes in Texas. That's where all industry, that's where a lot of things are going. So, you know, there's a lot of bonuses to, you know, you're bringing in an upstart. Not just for the team, you know, a good team, but the potential of, you know, fresh blood in the Houston area.
Well, the other thing, the reason that they may not want Houston is because there's competition in recruiting in Texas that they might not want to, you know, have another team from Texas in there that they're competing with.
Yeah, because you know who's actually stealing recruits from UT, from the Longhorns?
Well, I know
TCU. Fort Worth. They're in Fort Worth. They're right on the border of Dallas. So they are stealing UT recruits blind ever since they moved into mostly when they moved into the Mountain West and started, you know, looking, you know, getting a lot of airtime thanks to their quarterback. Who's the Bengals quarterback?
Andy Dalton.
Yeah. I mean, Andy Dalton put him on the map, took him to the big bowl games, and that, you know, skyrocketed TCU into getting the Big 12. And they're, you know, they're relatively competitive. They weren't as good last year, but give them a few years. They've got a good coach. But one of the teams that they're talking about too is Memphis, and I really don't know why.
I don't know why.
Let's skip these guys.
They've had one good year really, and even that last year they were pretty good, but they kind of towards the end of the season fell apart. So,
you know, another team that is being talked about, Northern Illinois.
Yeah, I saw that on there too. They're a pretty good team. I don't know about their, you know, how big the school is and all that stuff, but they play in
20,000 enrollment.
They play in a really shitty conference. So
yeah, their stadium only holds 24,000. They said the only reason that Northern Illinois would even be suggested is because it might poach on recruits from the Big Ten territory.
Yeah,
here's one. Of course, I don't even know why they even considered this. This would be like the Big 12 playing an FCS school every week. SMU.
Yeah, the only reason they were mentioned is because they're in Texas.
The reason that they were also is because their basketball team had Larry Brown, but you know he's not. I don't think he's going to be around for very long. So. It would help in travel. It's in Dallas.
Well, the basketball team was pretty good last year, I know. But they it seems like ever since they got the what they call the death penalty that they've never recovered.
Yep. Let's move over before I get to the two Florida, other Florida teams. Fascinating that they're trying to pick up Florida. Let's look at the potential of Boise State.
I think it's too far, but
You mentioned the fact that Boise State's basketball team had regular season
success.
I think
it's good enough. Yeah,
bounced the NCAA tournament two of the last three seasons. Let's see.
Yeah, they're getting better in basketball ever since they joined the Mountain West, which is a pretty good basketball conference in general. They past couple seasons they haven't been that good, but Boise State did win the Mountain West last year. So, they have a solid basketball program that's getting better. So I think they're good enough basketball wise, and obviously they're good enough football wise.
Yeah, the other side of the coin is Boise State is sort of would have the transition or, you know, sort of the channel, because they're going to pick up games against Pac-12. They naturally in their off-season games will pick up the Washingtons or the Oregons or the Oregon States. So that's going to bring the I think you're going to see this too. You know, when I talked about some of the requirements are going to be necessary for the playoffs is that you're going to have to ditch your old crappy, out-of-conference schedule, and you're just going to have to start playing teams that are in other Super Fives. Well, it's easier for Boise State to start playing some of the Pac-12 teams as their out-of-conference schedule versus, say, who's Alabama going to play? They're going to play ACC teams?
But Boise State actually has been. I remember a few years ago.
They traveled to Georgia.
They played Oregon.
The Georgia Dome.
In
they played
first
West Virginia,
game.
I think. They played Oklahoma. Or, well, no, they didn't play Oklahoma. They played, who did they play?
Let me see.
Kansas State?
They're playing. I know that they played Oregon one of their first games. They actually played, I don't know if you remember this, when Garrett Blunt actually punched one of the Boise State players in the face.
Yeah, I watched that game.
Yeah, me too. And,
and
got suspended for the season.
Yeah, because Oregon lost.
Yeah, they had because that's when that's one of the years I think they were in the top five, and they went to one of the major bowl games, actually.
Now, here's the interesting thing about Boise State is when it started its rise out of FCS into FBS.
I mean, this year they're playing Oregon State and Washington State.
Yeah, so they're playing two.
Yeah.
And Washington State's not a pushover.
No, they're pretty good.
They got the old Red Raider coach, Mike Leach.
So they're usually playing Pac-12 teams. The thing is, though, I don't know, you know, recruiting-wise, will that help? It will definitely help Boise State, but will that help any of the other teams to get into the state of Idaho? I mean, probably not. And that might be one of the reasons why you had mentioned the Pac-12 and why they didn't pick them up instead. And I don't know why neither, because instead of like Colorado or somebody. Maybe it's because of the state that they're in. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's still the capital of Idaho, but, you know, Idaho is a small, it's big, you know, area wise, but I mean, it's a small state. I don't know, recruiting-wise, if there's a lot of players coming out of Idaho. I don't know. I wouldn't think that they're recruiting the majority of their players from Idaho, but, you know, maybe they are. I don't know.
Well, actually, they get a lot of from California. They get a ton of three-star players from California.
Yeah, I'm looking at like their roster.
Yeah, they don't get a lot of people from.
Yeah,
you know, they don't get a lot of five stars, four stars, but they get the three stars that the California, the Pac-12 teams, like, eh, we only take four and fives. You know, you're a bunch of just losers. And it, you know, there, I forget the name of the coach before Chris Peterson. You know, Chris Peterson went over to Washington.
Yeah.
But that guy, he took Boise State to. He was the one, I think, who won the game against Oklahoma, and then he got the job and went to Colorado. And he sort of fizzled out in Colorado and sort of moved on. But Chris Peterson then picked it up and just took him, you know, straight in. The great game against TCU in the big bowl game where they lost by one, and then the next time they played TCU, they beat them.
Yeah. They had those, I think it was 2 years in a row that they had played them or something, and 1 year Boise State won and 1 year TCU won.
Exactly. So with that being said, then Chris Peterson got in Washington. Now is the coach going to be able to carry on the tradition? Because you get a decade of Boise State, and if you think about it, you know, yeah, they played in the Mountain West, and everybody's going to downplay it. But I don't care what conference you play in. When you as a team go like 54-1 in the 4 years that Kellen Moore was quarterback, I don't care if you're like playing FCS. Nobody does that in conference.
If you look at it, I mean, how many teams go undefeated each year? Usually none. This
one
year,
to two, it, and it's more difficult.
A lot of times it's none. I mean, this year there was actually regular season. There was two. There was Clemson and Iowa, and then Iowa kind of fell apart.
They lost to Michigan State.
Yeah. Right, but that was in the conference game. But, I mean, regular season they went undefeated, and Clemson went undefeated until the championship game. But usually there is not an undefeated team. It is hard to go undefeated.
It's been even harder since they've gone to these
no matter what conference. But no matter what conference you're in, it's still hard to go undefeated.
Oh, absolutely. You know, you figure in some of these that have lesser. It's like in the Pac-12. Okay, the one side of the Pac-12 has monster teams. You've got USC, you've got Stanford, you've got Cal, you got Oregon, you got Oregon State. That's one side of the coin. Okay, the other side of the coin, you have Arizona State, Arizona, Colorado, Utah, Washington, Washington State. Now, tell me which side of those brackets is easier. The side with Arizona State. And you can feasibly, you know, go through and win all your division games and have to pick up one or two against USC, Cal, Stanford, or Oregon. So you would only have to play really two monster games to go undefeated if you're in the Pac-12. But if you're in a place like the SEC where you got to play Georgia, Florida, Ole Miss and Mississippi State, who are no pushovers anymore. Texas A&M, Missouri, LSU. You know,
it's not going to happen if you're in the West. If you're in the East and you get to, you know, you don't get Alabama and LSU in your schedule or something like that.
See, that's why Iowa went undefeated, because they didn't play.
Well, they did have an easy schedule, but still.
They didn't play Ohio State. They didn't play Michigan. No. And they only played Michigan State in the conference championship.
Right, right.
But other than that, they played a bunch of, you know, the Indianas, Northwesterns, which sort of fell apart after that Michigan game. Illinois, which is, you know, perennial loser.
Wisconsin was really the only solid team that they beat, not even close to its usual. And it was a 10-7 game.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, they didn't have they had an easy schedule, and that's why. They still going undefeated. Like I said, is impressive no matter what. Yeah, I'm looking at their schedule, and really, you know, they played Indiana, they played Maryland, they played Purdue, Nebraska on an off year, Pittsburgh, and Illinois. Wisconsin. They played Illinois State, which was a FCS team. Yeah. So, yeah, okay. I mean.
And they may have played Iowa State, yeah.
Minnesota had a pretty good year, but, I mean.
What's pretty good for Minnesota, you know?
Yeah.
We're not talking.
So, no, I mean, they didn't play any ranked teams. Which means next year their schedule is going to
Michigan, you know, be really, really on them. Okay, let's go through the breakdown. If pick up to four. Four potential, because I think the expansion is eventually going to go to 14, but pick four, and then pick your two sure ones.
Well, I think it's BYU and Houston.
BYU and Houston
are the two teams that are probably. And I didn't at first. I didn't think BYU, but the more I thought about it, because they were talking about what's too far away, and it's really not. And Boise, the only reason that I think that they wouldn't pick Boise is it doesn't really expand their recruiting at all, the state of Ohio to Idaho. And that I think it's a little too far away. And from what I was hearing, they don't want to expand west. Now, if it's four teams, you know, UCF had a couple good years there where they actually went to a I still can't think of the fucking name of the bowls, but they went to one of the elite bowls.
Yeah, like a Cotton or a Peach Bowl or something like that.
Yeah, and they had one loss.
Yeah, here's the two that we didn't touch on, UCF and USF.
USF has been picked by some people to actually win the East or whatever division they're AAC. in the AAC, which is, you know, the American Athletic Conference, which doesn't really mean much, but they've never had they were always picked to do well when they had BJ Daniels, and they would go like 5-0 and then they'd go in the conference play, and then
the problem with USF
suck.
South Florida, Their record their past 5 years is 22-39.
Yeah, that's why it's not, you know. I could see UCF as a possibility.
Well, the other thing is, you know where USF plays?
Don't they play near Orlando as well?
No, they play at Raymond James Stadium. They play in the Tampa Bay Buccaneers Stadium.
Right.
Yeah. So they've got access to that, have a top 20 TV market. The problem is their basketball team sucks. Their women's team is decent, but their men's team is just horrific. They really don't have much to offer besides, and their football team's been on the downside.
Yeah,
the one that stands out, though, is UCF, because here's the thing. Their enrollment is 60,000.
No, that's huge, too.
And their stadium only holds 44,000.
I think a lot of those are commuters, though, too, but not that that matters. So I think if they really want to expand into Florida, because I don't think that Florida State at this point would leave, then that they would be a possibility. And as far as the last team, you know, I don't know. I mean, maybe they do go for Boise.
You know, the thing about it is Orlando is virtually as far from the Midwest area as Boise is. Think about this. The closest place to Boise is Lubbock.
But they were saying Texas Tech, what I
1,252 people or 1,252 miles. The closest to US or UCF is West Virginia, which is a full 900 miles. And West Virginia is still farther away from Kansas and Kansas and Texas and things like
that. Yeah, but I think it's they're willing to, like, because of the market there.
That's the big thing in the market.
You know, with Florida, and I don't think you get that market in Idaho. But the other team, maybe Cincinnati, but the problem with Cincinnati that I heard is that the Big Ten, it might piss them off that they're kind of, you know, getting into their territory, even though Cincinnati's not even, you know, they're not in their conference or anything. But they're,
I don't think they're really pissed them off, but you got to remember, too, is that if everybody goes to 16, Big Ten needs to pick up two more.
I don't know why they didn't ask Cincinnati before, why they took Maryland and Rutgers.
They grabbed Maryland. Oh, my God.
I know. I don't know why they didn't grab Cincinnati. And maybe I don't know why Cincinnati wouldn't want to go.
Well, you know, the other side of the coin is that they're in a conference, and they may have had been under contractual with the conference, and it may have cost too much to get out of it.
It's possible
to look into. Anyway, we hashed out the Big 12 things, the rankings. Have you taken a look at both the AP and the coaches poll rankings?
Yeah. So, well, I didn't see the AP.
They're relatively close. It's like at 5 and 6.
I saw whatever was, I think, just the ESPN, but yeah.
The coaches picked Ohio State 5 and LSU 6, and AP is opposite, switch them. The other thing is that the coaches picked Stanford's for 7 and Michigan 8, and the AP has Michigan 7 and Stanford 8.
Yeah, so I kind of went through the conferences as well. Individually, and I tried to listen to as much as possible. So maybe we can go through the conferences and also go through, you know, the rankings as well. And the thing, you know, and you had mentioned this earlier about the rankings, but not this point, but just about preseason rankings. It's good to have preseason rankings because it gives us something to fucking talk about and measure and all that shit. But it's not, because you had mentioned how, you know, you got to go come up. If you're not ranked and you have to go up each week and go through all that shit. So really, I mean, rankings are just based on, they're estimating how good they think the team is. And that's it. You know, whether it's the AP or the coaches. And the coaches, I don't even know how much effort they really put into that shit, to be honest, because they're busy with their own fucking teams. So, you know, it's unfair in a way, because what if, you know, you're not ranked, but in the first game, you know, you play somebody. What if Auburn beats fucking Clemson in the first game? I mean, you know, I'm sure they'll end up in the rankings, but if it's, or Hawaii beat Michigan, are they going to end up in the ranking? I mean, I don't think that's going to happen, but I'm just saying the hypotheticals that teams could beat other teams and they were just really off. If you compare the preseason rankings to the end, and I've done that before, a lot of times they're way off. And there's teams that, you know, drop off pretty quick and never come back, and you don't see them at the end of the season.
Well, in my opinion, when teams lose, sometimes they don't drop off enough. You know, if you're Ohio State and you lose to, say, Minnesota, or if you barely beat Minnesota, Minnesota's unranked, and it's in Ohio Buckeye Stadium. To me, if you don't dominate a game at home that you're supposed to dominate, then you should, the voters should pretty much boot you out. I am totally against the philosophy that if you win, no matter how you win or barely win or against who, if you win, you should never lose spots in the thing. To me, that's bogus.
What do you think about? So you have, and USC is actually one of the teams, and in the AP top 25 I'm looking at, and I also have up all the where I can look at the schedules and stuff like that, as well as covers.com is a really good place if you want to look at odds too, just so you know, not to give them to promote them, but just for you. I know everybody else is hearing it obviously as well, but it's just a pretty good place. But so USC is playing Alabama, you know, week one. And now I totally forgot what I was going to say, because I was going to ask you, what do you think of shit? That's not a good thing to do on the radio. Well, oh, sorry. Schedules. So USC is playing Alabama. That's why I thought of it. Alabama week one, right? If you look at USC's schedule, they have one of the toughest schedules, and there's rankings in the schedule. So you look at USC, right? They play Alabama, then they play Utah State, which, you know, they're an average team. Then they play Stanford, Utah, ASU, Colorado, Arizona, Cal, Oregon, Washington, UCLA, Notre Dame.
They play two Super Five teams out of the three, and the other one is Big West.
Yeah, I mean, they're playing basically based on the preseason rankings, right? They're playing number one, number eight. Utah is probably top 30, number 24, number 14, number 16, and number 10. They're playing four ranked teams in the last four games all in a row as well.
Right. And you know what they're ranked in the
20.
In the, yeah, 17 in the coaches poll and 20
in AP.
AP.
So yeah. What do you think, though, about, you know, when you're talking about teams dropping on the, you know, in the rankings and stuff, if they lose, you know, you could take teams.
If you play a team that's ahead of you in the rankings and you lose close, especially if you lose in their stadium, then you should probably either stay where you are or drop just a touch. But if Alabama loses to a ranked 20th team, I don't care if they're USC, then Alabama should be in the bottom, you know, bottom 15.
Right. No, definitely. But what happens is that you have these teams that maybe they're undefeated, maybe they dominated every game, but they just don't have the schedule. And then you have teams, like you mentioned, LSU or something had two losses one season when they played for the championship, but I think one was like a really close loss to Alabama. For example, I was thinking of this earlier. Do you remember last year, the Michigan State game where Michigan State won? It was a fluke where they like blocked a kick or something at the end of the game, and
Michigan was punting away, and the snap was horrible, and it went all the way to the end zone.
Yeah, it was a fluke. I mean, they should have never won that game. So you have something like that. Like, how far should Michigan drop for losing that game? So there's in college football, it's so much different than the NFL because you do have that huge gap between the best teams and the worst teams. Now, if they did what you said and made sure that they didn't play, you know, they maybe took Division One and got rid of half the teams or cut it way down and made sure, one, you don't play any teams in the FCS, and two, that you play. I mean, they should almost make it like, you know how in the NFL, how they do the schedule is you play the team that in your conference that ended up in the same spot. So if you were in first place, you play all the first place teams?
Yeah. You're going to play, if you had the, what they'll do is they'll, the strength of your conference with the emphasis on the best team will play an equal conference as long as they haven't played that conference in the last 3 or 4 years. So you may get stuck with playing, you know, because the problem is last year the NFC West played the NFC North. How was anybody to know that Minnesota was going to be
right? Well, that part is different, but I'm saying within your own conference. So.
In your own
conference, you'll play the first place team. So whoever finished first, like the Patriots finished first, and I'm trying to remember who else. Did Cincinnati finish first in their division? Yeah, so they'll play Cincinnati, they'll play Denver, and they'll play – fuck, who finished first in Houston, I think. So they'll play all them.
Houston won the South.
But one of those divisions, they're going to play the whole division anyway because they alternate. Right. But
there are in the NFL, there are pseudo non-conference games where you'll play a team that nobody else in your division will play.
Right. As opposed to, based on where they finished in the year before.
Right.
So, and maybe there could be something similar to that. But, you know, to your point, as well as doing these fucking picking your own teams that you're going to play is ridiculous.
Well, like
outside
I said,
a conference.
Like I said, the big difference between the NFL and the NCAA is that there's no such thing as a conference or a division president in the NFL. Okay? Divisions are just sort of nomenclatures created underneath the NFL umbrella. In college football, each conference is an autonomous kingdom unto itself.
Right.
And the NCAA doesn't get involved unless the problem cannot be resolved at the conference level, or if it is something dealing with legality. So for you know, tradition in college football is that your conference schedule games are determined by the conference, you know, your conference headquarters. The dates of them are being done as you on the
right. Well, conference is all set. That's not a problem because they take care of that, and that's
right,
fine.
But your out of conference are usually done actually 3 to 5 years in advance.
Yeah, they usually set up. They might set up like a 4 year thing or 2 year thing, or you know, like UNLV did a deal with UCLA, where last year UCLA came here. And this year they go to L.A.
So I'll give an example. There was a news report a few months ago that I was listening on the sports channel, and they said that it's official. Arizona State has signed up for a home-and-home with LSU for the 2020-2021 season.
Yeah, they do it like that, like years out.
Exactly.
And it's
more difficult. And, you know, the hard part is because they do that years out, you may have scheduled, say, Kansas when Kansas went 10-3 one year.
Right. And then they suck.
And then 5 years later, when you play them, they're 2-13 or 2-11, you know.
Well, they could make rules that you can only schedule, you know, a certain amount of years ahead, and you have to play one. I would make a rule that FCS games don't count on your record. Period. That's it.
No, to me that if you play an FCS game, you get negative points on strength of schedule. Negative.
Well, I'm saying that it doesn't even count as a win. That it doesn't go to your record.
I don't like that because when they're figuring out the five criteria for the playoffs, strength of schedule is one of them. So if you just took them out, then it's going to make somebody like Alabama's strength of schedule much better.
Well, yeah, you could still
add 115.
I see what you're saying. Well, you could do both. You could do both. You can add. You could subtract it and make their out of strength of schedule like so it goes down. But still not counted as a win at the same time. I mean, you could do both. But, yeah, I mean, they need to see
they
what...
They need to impose rules.
But
and
what,
the NCAA
what,
has to... Yeah. The conference or the NCAA has to come down and say, if you want to create these Super 5 conferences, then these are the rules that you must do to be a member of the conference, okay? You must schedule two of your three... conference or out of conference games, two of your three games must be against teams in among the Super 5 schedules.
No, I'd say all of them. I mean,
no, I'll do that because what you've done then is you said to anybody outside the Super 5 conferences,
oh, okay, you're
that your
outside
game's
the
meaningless.
Okay, no, you could do that, but no FCS.
Oh, no FCS.
Games.
No FCS. But say like a Connecticut. or well, Cincinnati.
That's fine. Oh. Like with what USC did, right? So
Notre Dame, since they're not in really a conference, you know, that type of
thing. Yeah, but they're a good team. But so USC, right, they scheduled three games, and the rest of it is conference. So they scheduled Alabama, Notre Dame, and Utah State. And Utah State is a pretty solid team. They could beat USC. They're probably not going to. But, I mean, they've had, you know, 8-4, 7-5 seasons. I mean, they're a solid team. They're not
What's interesting is Boise State, when they showed that they could beat teams, they wanted to have tougher non-conference schedules. And they ended up playing Virginia Tech at a neutral site. That. They played Georgia at the Georgia Dome, which is virtually a home game for Georgia.
That too.
But those teams refused to go up to Boise and play in the Blue Stadium. They only said, you got to play in our area, our location, but we're not going to play at your place.
Yeah,
see,
that's not
to
right.
me, that's... You know,
see, even UNLV.
If I was doing the ranks and looking at the playoffs, and that was your response, then you'd get a ding for playing whoever you know.
Well,
that says you aren't good enough. You want to play for a national championship, but you're not. You're cowards to go play up Boise.
Well, I mean, both Arizona and UCLA, when they made deals with UNLV, they did the same thing. They did home and away. I mean, not the same thing as what you just said. They did it equal. They did one year, we'll go there, and you go there.
SEC has a tendency more than anybody to refuse to leave and go play home and home.
Yeah, I think UNLV played Virginia Tech one year, and they had to go there, and it was just a one-year thing. But, see, the thing is, with conferences like the SEC, they don't give a fuck about their out-of-conference schedule because they know that they have enough teams within their conference that it doesn't make a difference. Their strength of schedule is going to be high no matter who they pick out of conference. Yep. And that's why they do it. They're like, well, why are we going to, you know, play tough games when we have to play in this tough conference? And that's where, you know, to me, even though I'm more for, you know, the independence of the conferences and schools and everything, but if the whole, you know, you cut down the Division I and you actually set up conferences, you know, and try based on region as much as possible and try to make them as equal as possible. Now, that can change. The whole thing is with college football, that can easily change. You know, you could be good for a decade and then suck for a decade. So that's kind of hard to do. But to make them to try to make them more equal than to have, you know, conferences that are like the SEC. But what I want to do is go through each conference briefly, and then we can I really didn't make any notes about the shitty teams, but we may have difference in opinion on who's, you know, the best team in each conference and who's going to win the division and championship. So we could start with the SEC, being that I actually have that tab first if you want. So in the SEC, we have the East and the West. Obviously, the East being not as good. The four teams that I even picked as, you know, okay or good teams that have a chance is, and I don't know if you would have any others, is really Georgia, Florida, and Tennessee, and then maybe Missouri, but I don't know.
South Carolina, the old ball coach retired. So
yeah, I don't think South Carolina is going to do anything.
Georgia's got a new coach. Mark Richt resigned or was fired or was told
forced to resign.
Yeah, forced to resign. So I don't see Georgia really, you know, unless they do something out of the extraordinary, they don't. I think they're going to have to go through some heartaches. Florida,
they're usually overrated, but they don't. One of the things with Georgia is they don't play Alabama, which is a positive for them. But Georgia, ever since I started following college football, based on their reputation, has always been, in my opinion, overrated.
Yeah, they tend to choke on a game. They may play tough against Florida or tough against Alabama, and that, but then they'll play somebody like Kentucky, and they'll get beat.
Yeah, they have just, those off games, and they're just they're not consistent. And
then once they lose their first game, then they go on a spell, and they'll end up losing three games in the conference.
Yeah, I haven't seen a solid year out of Georgia since I started following closely college football. And they got UNC their first game, which should be a good game. And they do play Ole Miss, but they don't play LSU. They don't play Alabama. So they don't have the hardest schedule. They play Tennessee, which we'll talk about them in a minute. I think they're overrated. And they play an FCS team, Nichols or something. And then in their division, they got Missouri, they got South Carolina, they got Vanderbilt. They should win all those games. They got Kentucky. Then they play Auburn. They play one of the Sun Belt schools or Conference USA. What is it? The University of ULL is what I think it's a is it Louisiana? I don't know. And then they play Georgia Tech.
Louisiana Lafayette.
Yeah, that's what it is. And they play Georgia Tech. So they have they don't have a tough schedule. So they could easily win 10 games and I mean still not be that good of a team, but
you know it's interesting you mentioned when we were talking Florida really has the you know they have their strong conference schedule, but their non-conference schedule is horrific. They play UMass, they play North Texas,
who's becoming independent,
and they play Presbyterian.
Yeah, so obviously they're gonna go. What do they play? Those the first three games, or no? They open up with or I'm looking
UMass,
at
Kentucky, North Texas. And then they don't play Presbyterian until the second to last game. Their only tough out-of-conference game, they have four out-of-conference, is Florida State, which is sort of an in-state rivalry that they're always going to play. But they don't have to play Alabama.
Yeah, they got FSU at the last game of the season.
They got LSU. Right. They got LSU, Georgia. Tennessee is going to probably be good.
See, I don't know about those are the three teams I think that would really have a shot at winning it. But Tennessee, same thing. I mean, I haven't last year they said they were going to be good. They seem overrated. I guess they got a good quarterback, but I don't know.
Well, they got a good coach. Their coach has been something of
yeah, and they're ranked ninth. But I mean, until I see something from them, you know, last year you really didn't. I mean, they had high expectations and really didn't do anything. And they're playing. You know, they open up at Appalachian State, which is an FCS team.
Tennessee Tech.
Then they play. They do play Virginia Tech. They play Ohio.
But Virginia Tech isn't expected. Beamer's gone, and you know they're not going to beat really anybody.
And Ohio, then they play two FCS games. They play whoever TNTC is.
Tennessee Tech.
So they're playing.
Here's the point: they're playing every single one at home. They're not going on the road for any.
Yeah, so they only got four road games, and their four road games are Vandy, South Carolina, Georgia, and Texas A&M. So that might be a tough game. So they don't have a tough schedule.
They got Alabama. They got Florida, Georgia. So those are gonna be three. But
Florida probably has the toughest schedule out of all of them. And you know, really, Florida, if they can get their offense, you know, on point and get a quarterback that can play, if they get good quarterback play, I mean, they could end up winning a division.
And, they may really only have two tough teams, and Alabama at home, Texas A&M on the road. Georgia, ironically, since they started playing at the Georgia Dome, it's not a home field advantage to them.
How far is it from Athens? Is it in Atlanta?
Yeah, it's in Atlanta.
Yeah, so that's probably why. So so who would you say? I would pick – I don't
gonna,
know. I'd pick Florida
I'm
to
pick
win
Tennessee
the East.
For that division. I'm going to pick Tennessee for that division.
It's possible. I just – I haven't – I got to see something from them, and I guess we'll see. And this, I guess, is the year for them to really show something. And they're ranked ninth, so – I guess we'll see what happens there. So in the West, I got Alabama, LSU, Ole Miss, and A&M, which I think it's
meh.
They're, you know, kind of like I don't know that they're going to compete.
They were let down last year, and it doesn't look like they have a quarterback that's going to.
They got questions at a lot of positions and at quarterback.
Ole Miss, so, Ole Miss wasn't Dak Prescott their quarterback last year? And now he's with the Dallas Cowboys, so they have a new quarterback. The thing about Alabama is they put Alabama number one. Alabama's got a new quarterback.
Yeah, they
nobody
do.
Knows what they're going to do.
But Alabama is one of those teams, and it's weird. You have like the LSUs and the Alabamas and all of these SEC teams that could easily recruit a really good quarterback, and they never do. I mean, you had AJ McCarron who went to the NFL, but as a backup.
Well, you know why? Is because quarterbacks, that position, the top recruiting quarterbacks, they're going to want to go to either if they in high school they were a spread offense guy, they're going to want to go to a high level spread offense team. If they're a strong arm quarterback, they're going to want to go to a team that's got a pro style that's going to mature them, you know, read defenses and mature them to be able to go into the pros. So most of the other players outside of quarterback want to play in their hometown teams. But the quarterbacks want to go to a system that
gets them ready for the NFL.
Them. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So, you know, LSU really just has quarterback questions. They got probably the best running back, definitely in the SEC, if not in college football. They got a great defense. It's just, you know, quarterback questions. If their quarterback can really, I don't know that he has to do much, just don't make mistakes. Alabama, same thing, you know, the questions at quarterback. They got defense. They lost their running backs. So I think it's really between Alabama and LSU. Ole Miss has a tough schedule. They play Florida State, and of course they play Alabama and LSU. And A&M as well. Alabama plays USC in the first game, but I don't think USC is going to beat Alabama. But the first game, you never know. Anything can happen, but I doubt it. So I don't know. That's a hard one, I think, between Alabama and LSU. I think I'm going to take LSU.
LSU's lost two of their top receivers. Both to injury.
Yeah,
so
but
far.
They've done it before with defense in a running game.
Yeah, but they have a kooky coach.
Yeah, the but coach the Mad Hatter.
Yeah, he'll lose games just like the number of times that he'll pull out of his butt. But LSU plays Alabama hard. But Saban is a much better coach.
Also,
if all things are equal, Saban's going to beat.
Alabama has lost to Ole Miss 2 years in a row.
Right. But Ole Miss has, Ole Miss had a monster defense. And last 2 years, they had Dak Prescott.
Well, and they're playing their first game at Florida State. And then they got Alabama the third game. Then they got Georgia. Then Memphis, then Arkansas, then LSU.
Yeah, they're ranked 11. So, I don't think they're going to be. they're going to barely be in the top 20 by the time halfway through the season. I think they're going to have a letdown this year. Like I said, they've got a new quarterback. Most of the rankings are based on last year's efforts.
Right.
I mean, think about it. 1 and 2 are the two guys who went to the championship game. Right.
So, and then as far as Alabama's schedule, they got Tennessee. They got USC, of course, Ole Miss, LSU. They play Chattanooga, and they play Western Kentucky. I mean, see, this is ridiculous. They play Kent State. They play Western Kentucky, and they play Chattanooga.
Yeah, USC's are only
that's like Florida, such bullshit.
Florida's doing the same thing. And Florida they also, States are only tough.
And they also draw, you know, this isn't their fault, but they play Kentucky. Their games from the East are Kentucky, Tennessee, and what was the other team that they played?
Vanderbilt.
Is it Vanderbilt?
I don't know. I'm not looking at the schedule.
No, it's Kentucky, Tennessee, and there's not another team fucking listed. Am I missing something here? Yeah, I only see Kentucky and Tennessee. Is that because they have four other fucking games? Unless there's a mistake here. They're only playing two teams out of the East.
Probably. Out of conference. They've got five or six in there. Yeah, they should play three.
So
let me check the schedule.
I would pick Alabama just based on their fucking schedule. Because really, the only tough teams they got is, you know, LSU, Tennessee, and, you know, Ole Miss. Who knows which way they're going to go. You know, Auburn's not going to be as good as they have been this year. And, you know, they got USC, but I don't, it's the first game. I think USC will probably improve as the season goes along. But so, yeah, I would take Alabama and Florida. And then of course, Alabama winning the conference there. So Big 12, I think the contenders really are, I got TCU, Baylor, Oklahoma State. Texas Tech has a great offense. If they could put together some defense, they could do something. Texas is just a question mark to me. I don't think they can do much. And, you know, I don't know. I would say Oklahoma is probably going to be the team.
I know why Alabama's not playing three out of that conference. They're not playing 13 games. They're only playing 12.
Everybody
but some of the teams now play 13. They'll schedule 13.
You can only schedule 13 if you play Hawaii in Hawaii.
Oh, that's weird.
It's because it's
okay. So
it is.
Oh, then we'll look at the way they got six in conference. They have four out of conference. That's 10, and then leave spot for two. Some of the teams may not.
Oh,
be
I know why.
In their conference.
I know why, because they have 14 teams in the SEC now. That's why. Right. So that makes sense.
Are cases where they may not play their own. I mean, the Big Ten schedule. There are seasons when Michigan does not play Ohio State. Now it's like one out of every 5 or 6 years, but that's an income. That's an
because they got 14 game. Teams in there. Yeah,
right.
So Big 12 is just you got all those.
That's
good
when they
offenses.
Want to go to 16. And to be honest, if they get to the point that each of the super conferences get to 16, then they can play. All in their division, they can play four out-of-conference games, and they don't have to play anybody in the other division, so that when you have the conference championship, you don't have the fear of playing some team twice.
Oh, I see what you're saying, that you, yeah. that you only play within your division. And
right. That's what I think they're going to eventually go to.
It's something I got to think about if I like it or not. But yeah, I think with the Big 12, the only team that stands out, although I think any of the TCU, Baylor, or Oklahoma State can win it, but I think, you know, Oklahoma is the only team that seems to have any defense.
Yeah,
and Texas Tech is great on offense.
It's going to be a matter of, like, Oklahoma
they have
last
no
year.
Defense.
Oklahoma should have been to the championship game, and Bob Stoops has a tendency to lose a game he shouldn't lose, which he did late in the season.
Yeah, who was it they lost to? They lost.
I don't remember last year, but
they lost to Texas.
Yeah, yeah, they got blown out by Texas, and Texas was.
And they were a shitty team last year.
You know, Texas had gotten beat by an FCS team, I think, earlier in the season.
So, yeah, but they're the only team that has both offense and defense.
I have no concept how Baylor is ranked after the fiasco, the debacle with their head coach, and 7 or 8 players getting kicked off, and another 8 players transferring out.
I don't know.
Yeah, that just tells you the bias of the super champ, you know, super conferences.
Maybe they had a lot of depth there. Yeah, I don't know, but yeah, I definitely go with Oklahoma there.
You know, if you take a look at it, it's interesting. Mid-American Conference, nobody ranked. Mountain West Conference, nobody ranked. Conference USA, nobody ranked. East American Athletic Conference, one team ranked.
Houston.
Yeah,
Mountain West had a bad couple years, but they usually always had like 2 teams ranked. And a couple years ago, the year before, I think it was Marshall that almost went undefeated, and then they lost their the conference game.
Yeah, something like that.
So, and we're kind of running out of time, but so Pac 12 in the north
is interesting. Yeah.
In the north, you got Stanford, Washington, Oregon, and Washington State.
This is the second year for Chris Peterson in Washington.
Well,
he did a little bit better than average last year, but they've got their core. He's had a full year now with his quarterback. And Stanford's got a new quarterback. Hogan's in the NFL.
Yeah.
So that's going to be fascinating. USC, UCLA, you know, the rest of them look pretty lethargic. So,
well, USC, I mean, I would say USC is the best team in the South, but because of their schedule, I don't know. Although they may be able to just put it together because it's based off of the conference schedule, not off your overall. So,
you know, UCLA's got some interesting games.
I would probably pick
A&M. They got UNLV, BYU, and that's the only, you know, they play few. They play because of what they do in the Pac-12. Is normally they only play 3 out-of-conference games. The rest are all in-conference.
Yeah, they play 9. So I think I would take UCLA just because of USC schedule. Otherwise, I would take USC. If somehow USC can beat Alabama, you know, I'll change my mind right there. But I would take UCLA just because of the fact of USC schedule. You know, who knows what's going to happen with Utah and Arizona, and Arizona State are more, especially Arizona State, I think is more like rebuilding.
USC by far has a tougher schedule.
Yeah, that's why I would take UCLA. Yeah.
I would take UCLA in the South. I'm gonna go out on a limb and I'm gonna take Washington.
A lot of people, listened to, they were like, Washington's gonna go undefeated.
They're not gonna go undefeated, but
I would take Stanford, but It depends, because it all depends on the quarterback.
Stanford has probably the best player in all of college football in his
Christian
team.
McCaffrey?
By far. He should have won the Heisman last year. To me, that was a racial bias.
And they thought he was going to leave, because one of the things I was listening to had him leaving. So but he didn't end up leaving. So I would take Stanford and UCLA, and then I would say probably Stanford wins the Pac-12, but it could go either way. And if USC can, you know, put together some wins over those teams.
You almost can't call it this thing. I'm going to wait until the USC-Alabama game. If USC loses close game to Alabama, then I'm going to put USC above UCLA.
Yeah, I think they're a better team.
Blown out by, say, you know, I'm talking, to me, blown out in college is more than 14 points. And not like the NFL, 14 points is a blowout in the NFL, but to me, a blowout in college is between two big teams. If it's 14 points or more, then that's a, you know, that's a blowout. Anything less is, you know, a possession or right. or a bad luck call. But the the thing is if USC beats Alabama or comes very, very close, say within 5 points, then I'll pick USC in the South. Otherwise, I'm going to pick UCLA because of the USC schedule. And Stanford has the best player in college football, but they have a new quarterback.
It all depends on the quarterback. It's going to be
– Yeah. You Otherwise, know. I'm going to pick Washington because they've got most of their people coming back, and Peterson's
had a year. They got 9 on offense, 7 on defense coming back.
Yeah.
And their quarterback's coming back, and so is their running back, and they got a solid defense. So it's possible that, you know, they win. And Oregon's not going to be as good. Maybe they win 9 games.
I don't see anything with Oregon.
Washington State is kind of the dark horse there that could end
Washington
up,
State's
know,
like Texas
something.
Tech. You know what? They're going to put up 1,000 points, but their no defense is going to, yeah, and they're going to lose.
So in the Big Ten, you know, in the East, you got Ohio State, Penn State, Michigan State.
I'm going to pick Michigan State.
Michigan State only has 4 back on offense. They don't have their quarterback coming back. They do have a senior quarterback. They should have a good defense, but I don't know. I think I would take
Ohio State lost too many players.
Well, Michigan. JT Barrett's too. He has ups and downs, and yeah. I would take Michigan.
You know, I want to take Michigan, but I'm not sure of their quarterback. He was inconsistent last year. To me, it's going to be about Michigan's defense. If Michigan's defense doesn't do, you know, give up 42 points to Ohio State at home like they did last year, yeah. then, you know. But
yeah, that was
if
ridiculous.
Their defense is better, their quarterback, you know, another year under Harbaugh is going to be better. Yeah, I think I would pick Michigan, though. I just don't know yet how their defense is going to do. On the other side, I am going to go out on a limb. I don't think Iowa's going to.
Oh, in the West?
Yeah, I don't think Iowa's going to do what it is. I'm going to actually pick.
Yeah, Iowa's actually returning 8 players on defense. 7 on offense. Their QB,
they had a monster defense last year.
Yeah, and so they're returning most of their defense. Their quarterback is coming back. They got a really good running game.
Their quarterback was not very good, though.
They lost their kicker, and I you know, they had a lot of close games there. And
yeah,
I guess their kicker
played,
was really good.
Weaker schedule. I mean, you saw how Michigan State sort of beat their quarterback to death. What was the final score, like 14-12 or something like that? 13-12 in that game?
In the Michigan State-Iowa game?
Yeah.
I'd have to look it up, but let me see real quick. Well, you can, you know, keep going. I'll find it.
I'm going to – I haven't looked too much.
Oh,
in
here it is right here, actually. I had them up. 16-13.
14-12, 16-13.
Yeah, close game. So,
I'm going to go on a limb in the West. I'm going to go Nebraska.
Damn, I don't even think they're going to – I don't even know if they're going to make a bowl game. They got a lot of questions on, I think, defense, but their secondary is coming back, unexperienced defensive line. That's what I – kind of the notes I have. I'm going to take Northwestern, kind of go out on a limb as well.
Northwestern was supposed to really be decent last year, and then when they got shut out by Michigan, they fell apart like you wouldn't believe. But here's the reason why.
But they had that – maybe – I think they can take that experience. And they got a good schedule. Well, they do play Ohio State and Michigan State. But besides that, that's going to be two tough games.
Who's that?
Northwestern.
Yeah, well, so, I'm looking at the schedule in Nebraska, okay? They got Oregon at home. They're at Northwestern. They're at Wisconsin, at Ohio State. Those are going to be tough. And then at Iowa. So – those are going to be, but the rest of them are going to be pretty cakewalks. Wyoming, Fresno State, Purdue, Indiana, Minnesota, and Maryland.
And then so
out of there, I'm taking 1, 2, possibly 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They're going to have 8 for sure, and then they're going to have 4 toss-ups.
And so who wins Michigan State, Nebraska then?
Michigan, they don't play. Nebraska doesn't play.
No,
Michigan
but
State.
I mean, you picked Michigan State, so who?
Oh, Michigan State.
And
I'm going against my team.
I think Michigan.
I'm going against my team, Michigan. Only because
I hate Harbaugh. I can't stand him, but I think that he'll beat Northwestern, and I hope that's not what happens, but I think that's what will happen.
Harbaugh was the only reason I actually, I was neutral with San Francisco 49ers.
I can't stand him.
I know most people can't stand Harbaugh.
I hate both of the Harbaughs.
But you know what? I'd rather have an ass
the whole family.
Who's a good coach than the Schottenheimers who can't win the big game.
Oh, true. I remember the year they fucking... Marty Schottenheimer goes 13-3, loses the first fucking playoff game.
Yeah, because he's
he did it every fucking time.
Bastard. You got a team on the ropes, and you just run, kick, punt, run, punt, run, punt. Oh, we lost. Because then they let the team catch up, and then all of a sudden you got to put the ball in Philip Rivers' hands, and he threw an interception. That was that. He's. My brother will despise Schottenheimer for forever because he's a Cleveland Browns fan.
Wasn't he the coach when the Patriots came back and fucking they were 14-2, and the Patriots somehow came back in this unbelievable comeback and beat them?
Yeah, that was that game I was telling you about. That was the game that they were up, and then late in the game in the middle of the fourth quarter, run, punt. Now all of a sudden they're down by a little bit, and now they suddenly get into offensive mode, and Philip Rivers, threw the interception late in the game. So, he doesn't know how to, that's why.
Well, what they should do is have him coach the regular season, and then the playoffs get a different coach.
Yeah, that's been the big joke. That's why I love Bruce Arians. You know what? If you're up 40-0 in the fourth quarter, guess what? He's going for 55. I don't know how many times when it would be like 3rd-and-1 and under 2 minutes, and he'd throw a pass. Because he plays to win. He doesn't play not to lose.
Yeah. Well, running out of time here. But so the Mountain West, pretty much San Diego State and Boise State, I think. I don't know that there's anybody else that really is going to step up. Air Force was off and on last year. They beat Boise State, actually, but then they lost to some shitty teams. Utah State had the last couple of years they've been, in bowl games, but I think their quarterback should be improved, Boise State's in their second year, and I think San Diego State's bringing back a lot of people, and they got easy schedules. Boise State does play Washington State, though.
And Oregon State. So they're playing two.
Well, Oregon State is garbage this year. So I think. So I pick in the East, Boise State, and in the West. I don't know if they call them East and West in the Mountain West, but San Diego State. I would like Nevada or UNLV.
Well, San Diego State's got to play. San Diego State's got to play two decent teams. Cal, and then they go to Northern Illinois.
Cal always is you know, one of those teams that
they could score 45 points in the next game. They could score seven.
Yeah, well, they'll play really good out of conference, and then, you know, they'll be like 4 or 5-0, and then they'll end up finishing the season at like, you know, 6-6. It's just, I've seen them do it so many times.
Illinois game, I think they're gonna in their. By the time they get to. Yeah, and they don't even play Boise State. That's going to be interesting.
Yeah, so they would play them in the conference finals. And last year, San Diego State won, but they didn't play Boise. They played Air Force, I believe, and went 10-3. So I think Boise State will beat San Diego State this year and win the Mountain West. But
yeah, the only thing that's going to matter is what's the record. Because they will take somebody from, you know, just like they took Houston to get into a big bowl game. Can somebody from the Mountain West have a strong enough record to get an at-large bid to the big bowls?
Well, I'm hoping Nevada gets it back together and UNLV improves, but UNLV is not going to be good enough to win a division. Nevada, I think there's just... it's totally unknown. After Kaepernick, they had Cody Fajardo, who was did the same thing Kaepernick did, and he was pretty good at it. But he didn't have the team around him, so we'll see what happens with Nevada. But I don't think they're going to win the division. So ACC in the Coastal, I think it's between Clemson, Florida State, and Louisville. And I would go with Clemson. They still got Deshaun Watson, of course, and, you know, they're coming off that loss of national championship, but they really don't. I don't know that they have that tough of a schedule. I mean, they play Florida State, of course, and Louisville, but
I think Florida State's going to be the bridesmaid. Clemson should, in my opinion, should easily win that division. Coming out of the South, I think North Carolina is the only standout team. Yeah. Miami lost a number of players to injury here in the preseason. They're not going to be really anything. Virginia Tech, meh. You know, they're like has-beens.
And Georgia Tech has been bad the past couple years. They're having a down cycle right now. So yeah, I would say it's a repeat of last year. Clemson, North Carolina, and
yep.
Clemson.
That's good. That's the easiest to me. That's the easiest division to pick.
So then in the American, I got really Houston is really the only team. In the, I don't know what they
Houston
call it.
Houston and Cincinnati will probably go. And then.
Yeah, I'm not
Houston
sure about that, division, but I would guess Cincinnati as well, because I don't know any other team that's good enough to win that. And Houston, I think, will win that easily. I think they'll probably be just as good as they were last year, if not, maybe not just as good, but close enough to at least win the conference. So when it comes to, and we only got about 6 or 7 minutes left, when it comes to the playoffs and say the top 10 teams, who would you say you know, those teams are going to be.
Clemson, Florida State.
Well, first, I guess the top four, the playoff teams.
Clemson, Oklahoma.
So two from
Alabama, and then whoever's from the Big Ten. You know, I may switch to Michigan, like I said, after I see the first game in their defense.
Yeah.
But either Michigan, Michigan State, I think Ohio State's gonna falter. So I'm picking for the playoffs. It's gonna be Clemson, Oklahoma, Michigan. I'll pick Michigan, and then Alabama.
As I'm gonna say, Alabama, Clemson. I'm gonna pick LSU. I think that they
here's the problem.
Get in there, and
here's the problem. If they lose in the the from what I've been hearing, the playoff committee is doing its absolute best.
Not to allow two
from the same conference in the playoffs.
They had that one year where they played each other in the championship.
Right, but that was before the playoffs.
Yeah.
There's only been 2 years
of
playoffs.
It was. Yeah. So, okay, assuming that's not going to happen, then I will pick Michigan, Clemson, Alabama, and Stanford. But Stanford's an unknown, so I don't know. But Notre Dame, some question marks there. That's possible.
You know, Notre Dame last year had played three different quarterbacks. Their coach is like the LSU's coach. He's a fruitcake.
And maybe, you know, Houston's a possibility as well. So I guess if I'm listing the top 10, that would probably be it. So Alabama, Clemson, Michigan, Stanford.
And if Michigan State and Ohio LSU. State beat each other up, I would say the dark horse number five, might as well throw it in there, Washington Huskies.
Again, possible as well. They got them at, 14 right now?
18.
And 18 to 14. On coaches.
Yeah.
So... yeah, I mean, that's possible as well. And still, USC, I see what happens with Alabama. I mean,
I really don't see USC
beating
Stanford or Washington for the whole conference.
I don't think so neither, but, you know, anything's possible there. You have those years where it's just like, you know, I think Houston will finish in the top 10, and Iowa's question mark as well. See what they, you know, I don't think they're going to do what they did last year, but it's possible. Tennessee.
No, because you know what? Last year was a flip because they've been ranked higher, 3 or 4 years before, and they've just petered out. So I think last year was just a perfect storm for them. I don't see them do it this year.
Yeah.
Their coach, not Fry, but what is it? Kirk Ferentz. He's been in the hot seat leading up to last year, you know, really bad. So, you know, can he carry it over some more? I don't think so.
And then, I guess who is the, you know, those teams that, you know, could surprise everybody?
Well, the teams that could surprise, Tennessee.
Yeah, I mentioned question marks there.
Well, you got question marks, but
North Carolina, you know, I mean, last year they almost beat Clemson. So, but they did
UCLA
lose.
UCLA could surprise.
Yeah, I mean, they had a really high expectations last year as well.
Yeah, maybe they didn't have as much. Michigan State could surprise.
I think Florida. It depends on their quarterback, you know, if they get good quarterback play.
And who knows, Florida State. You know what? Their coach took them to Jimbo.
But I don't think that would be a surprise to people. I mean, they got them ranked at 4 anyway. Right. So I don't think people would be surprised if Florida State instead of Clemson makes it, although I don't think that's what's going to happen. But, you know, I think Florida State's going to be worse this year. I don't think they finish in the top 10. Maybe, but I don't think they're going to be as good as they've been. Even last year, I mean, you could see the drop from the year they won the championship. So, and they don't have a quarterback really. They have what, Sean McGuire, who you know, he's a senior, but he's not a great quarterback. So they're going to have to rely on their running game, although they do have a good running back. But I think Florida State definitely does not finish in the top five.
No, I don't think so either.
I think they're ranked at four because of Florida State won the championship 2 years ago. So, you know, just based on the name. So, well, that's all the time we have for tonight. I'd like to, of course, thank Ken for joining us and doing this special show. I hope everybody enjoyed it. Go to Ken's channel on YouTube, Ken Schortgen, and go to thedailyeconomist.com to get articles on geopolitics and the economy. And definitely check that out. And he'll be back in a couple weeks, and we'll be back to the economy and geopolitics. But this one is a fun show. So thanks again, Ken, for joining us and doing this.
Yep, yep. Have a great evening.
You too. So thanks, everybody. We will be back tomorrow. I appreciate everybody that tuned in for our college football special. I thought it was something that'd be fun to do, and that was needed maybe to change things up and do a fun show for once, or at least something that's not as negative as usual. So thanks, everybody. Hope you hear me tomorrow. Have a good night.
But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer. The way the system